organization. Mitt Romney implemented it. And so their plan was that. That was the capitalist solution. And it was insufficient, right? Yeah, it made some improvements, but it didn't do enough.
Yeah, Doug, what's his name? Burgum? Whatever the fuck's his name?
Doug Burgum.
He was blaming government for being too involved in healthcare, and that's why costs are so high compared to other countries that have healthcare guaranteed by the government.
If that's going to be your opinion, you need to come out and say, government out of healthcare, I'm going to end Medicare. I want to hear them say that. Anyone who says that is signing a political death sentence.
Mm-hmm. Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's the thing with all those programs. They work. And then once they start working, people are like, I still want to live. This is great. You know, like, why would you want to turn that off? That's ridiculous.
They're just like little kids, the way they show up and talk about what they want to talk about. And they don't listen. No offense to little kids. But, like, you know, they're asking them direct questions. And
my 2.5-year-old is very offended right now.
My bad. But they're just not – there's no way they're going to answer any of the questions. I just wonder, can any of these guys realistically – beat Joe Biden in like actual election.
They're not giving anything any competition right now. It's like kids in the playground, like you said, just 2-year-olds. But it's just children in a playground, and they're choosing who to bully on stage and who to focus on. We're not getting anything that's actually going to help the people. Choose who the better leader could be. Right now, you guys are in competition with each other. You guys want the spot for presidency. You can't just keep on blaming Joe Biden. What does it look like if you become our leader, our president? How does that help us? How does that help our children that we may have during your time in office? Like, what does that look like when you get into office? What will you fight for? Like, I mean, I don't hear anything.
No one there even has any charisma to hide the fact that they have no policy. Like, it's one thing. Someone there could potentially, you know, beat Biden if they had some charisma, and that's how a lot of presidents just end up winning. No one is actually good at lying. So that's
Donald Duck joke? Did you not hear that?
I was gonna say, man.
That's already gone viral.
I was impressed.
He's like, you know, you're ducking, and you won't be called Donald Trump. We should call you Donald Duck. I'm embarrassed about that. That's gonna be a viral.
Workshop that shit. You know he did.
Where they're like, he went after Donald Trump. He thinks that's gonna be like a headline. When in fact, people are gonna be like, that was like, it didn't give what you thought it would give.
So
like, the focus was on healthcare, and you're talking about Donald Trump. The focus is on immigration, and you're focused on Donald Trump. Get out of his hair, get out of his nuts, and focus on the people.
That's like a bad dad joke.
Yeah.
Better than that.
I was embarrassed. I was like,
you were president with those kind of jokes?
And yes, guys, viewers, the volume is max. See. Most people are not complaining, but some are complaining. But just so you all know.
American students, they are in academic trouble. They have lower scores in math and reading. There's chronic absenteeism.
Every one of these people need to just look at the camera for this question and say, oh, fuck them. Because that's how they actually feel. Yeah.
But South Carolina, your home state, still has not enacted university school choice. And even the current expansion won't be fully implemented until 2027.
No charter schools, Nikki. That's bad. Gotta privatize.
So what would you do right now?
Well, and school choice isn't the only answer, but I'll tell you it's not out of a lack of trying that we didn't try and get school choice in South Carolina. What I'll tell you, first of all, is we have to acknowledge the fact that 67% of our 8th graders are not proficient in reading or math. Over 80% of our 8th graders aren't proficient in history or civics. And recently they came out and said our 12th and 13-year-olds are scoring at the lowest levels they've been scoring in reading and math in decades. So the first thing we've got to do is we've got to make sure we catch our kids back up. We have to make sure they can read. A child that can't read by 3rd grade is 4 times less likely to graduate high school. We need to do reading remediation. We need complete transparency in the classroom. No parent should ever wonder what's being said or taught to their child in the classroom. We need to make sure that we have school choice so that there's competition. We need to move all the programs from the federal government down to the states and let states decide what education looks like in their states. And we need
they're already doing that and they're past the kids.
Let's put classes back in our high schools and let's get our kids building the things that we know that we can make. When we start to focus on
It's an unfortunate freeze frame.
If we really bring in
that parental involvement, that's when we'll start to see a difference. But we've got to get parents back included. We've got to quit spending time on this DEI and CRT and instead focus on financial literacy, on digital literacy, and on making sure that our kids know what they need to do to have the jobs of the next generation.
They have to know about.
On the subject of education, a question for Governor Christie. Students in your state are getting high marks on their report cards, but minorities are not doing well with math and reading. Black and Hispanic students averaging 29 points lower than white students in New Jersey. Would you address minorities first?
You have to address all students. And look, in our states,
all students matter,
frankly. Before I was young, the gap was close to 50%.
That was what he just did.
What we did was institute more charter schools and more Renaissance schools and more public school choice in New Jersey with innovative solutions in cities like Camden, where now we took what was the worst
early underway in St. Petersburg, Russia, with Putin ordering 3,000 nuclear missile troops to be combat ready.
This public school system is no longer run by the public. It is run by the teachers' unions in this country. Randy Weingarten and her crew are absolutely strangling. They are taking the
Randy Weingarten and her crew. What is this, like the Jets and the Giants? Just Randy Weingarten and teachers coming down the alley.
There is no chance.
I feel like he's got another singer.
Hold away from the teachers' union every day. They have an advocate inside the White House every day for the worst of their teachers, not for our students to be the best they can be. A president of the United States has to take on the teachers' union. I did it in New Jersey, and I will do it as president of the United States.
To be applied for their personal benefit. You have said slaves develop skills in spite of slavery.
I'm so happy they're asking this through space.
For the sentence of slaves, this is personal. What is your message to them?
So first of all, that's a hoax that was perpetrated by Kamala Harris.
No, it is not.
Secret iPhone trick nobody knows about. You don't have to pay for more storage. Use
it's over, apparently.
The system definitely does not agree with anything. Everything was created.
I was waiting, Peter, when you were going to ask me that question.
Well, here we go. You tweeted Trump stole an election. You tweeted Brian Kemp stole an election. If denying election results is extreme now,
let's be really clear. That comparison that you made is just ridiculous.
we recently also, I actually held a demonstration for my colleagues here at the Capitol, where we brought in folks who, before our eyes, hacked election machines. Those that are being used in many states, but are not state of the art from our perspective. We're very concerned because there's only three companies. You could easily hack into them. It makes it seem like all these states are doing different things, but in fact, three companies are controlling them.
43% of American voters use voting machines that researchers have found have serious security flaws, including back doors. These companies are accountable to no one. They won't answer basic questions about their cybersecurity practices, and the biggest companies won't answer any questions at all. Five states have no paper trail, and that means there is no way to prove the numbers.
You tweeted in 2016 Trump stole.
Election. I was waiting, Peter, when you were going to ask me that question.
Well, here we go. You tweeted Trump stole an election. You tweeted Brian Kemp stole an election. If denying election results is extreme now,
why would so that let's be really clear. That comparison that you made is just ridiculous.
Without spending hundreds of dollars every month on a gym subscription.
Easy. Download the pop.
You're a wingman? I love chicken wings, but I'm not buying anything. I'm just here for game night at a bar tonight.
Okay.
I might play some Tony Hawk Pro Skater 4.
Dude, I fucking love you.
Have you heard of Proven Ground?
Yeah.
Remember Eric Sparrow, the enemy in the game?
Yeah.
He also voiced on Drake and Josh. Remember the guy who gives him the games? In the episode of Drake and Josh, who wears his lucky shirt, Josh.
I don't remember that one in particular, but I know Drake and Josh.
Ben Dickerson, who voices Eric, is in the show. He's a good character in the game. He was his best friend.
Who's your second favorite character?
The skater in the game.
Okay.
We're doing a live skit.
You want in on it?
I like rap a lot. You like Eminem?
Who doesn't?
I've seen 8 Mile like, a lot of times.
Are you a wingman?
Yes, what's a wingman?
You tell me.
I like chicken wings.
Wingman. You wing.
Now you know you saw me, cuz.
Hello, my name's Aquarium. How may I help you?
Yeah, I'm just calling about the dolphin you guys have in the dirty tank. You guys have already killed the orca, and I'm trying to see if what your plan is with this dolphin, or can I have him and set him free? The dolphin? You know, the one in your tank that's shut down?
Hello, my name's
Brian.
I'm going to help you.
Hi, I called a few minutes ago. I was trying to talk to someone about Leahy.
Okay.
I was just wondering what's going on with it.
If you would like any updates or anything like that, you can just follow our social media.
You guys don't really post about it on social media. It's kind of hidden in your closed-off area, but, you know, after seeing...
Hello, my name's Aquarium. How may I help you?
As for me, I cook so masterfully, ain't gotta pay a chef. I'm older now, but still I'm cutting edge. I'm like a bayonet from out the veil, we OSHA certified. You gotta wear your vest, too many homicides, a lot of sliding, they good at making decks. Thanks to God, I made it out the city. Most would say I'm blessed, my greatest flex is that I made a milli. Feel like I'm Bangladesh, I hate the press, refusing interviews whenever they request. Niggas fake, progressive, and woke, I started saying less. I had to stop it, peaked how they profit off of racial stress. Some activists got so rich they probably wish we stay oppressed. Studio steppers moving extra on songs faking rep. Only breaking bad in the lab. Thought y'all was making meth. Niggas making threats and I laugh. That's cause you ain't a threat. Don't ask how I feel about no rappers. Shit, they okay, I guess. Incoming car, press the button. The one nothing to say except he FaceTimed to ask for a feature and saw the face of death. I'm on your song, your stream's going up. Not quite the Drake effect, but don't complain, bitch, take what you get and cut the label check. My table's set, I died on your favorite. One verse will take his breath. I probably put more niggas on pause than Cam and Mason Beth. My agent get a whole lot of calls. It's like he paid the ref. These bitches out here looking like Steph on a late contest. Wide open, shooting they shot. Don't even waste your breath. I've been stopped fucking you dots. Ain't got no patience left. Say that shit for one of them niggas that rock the fake protects. My paper stress just like a Laker before he break a sweat. Sign, greatest yet. For me, I cook so masterfully. So masterfully, ain't gotta pay a chef. Ain't gotta pay a chef. I'm older now, but still I'm cutting edge. I'm like a bayonet from Optiville. We OSHA certified. You gotta wear your vest. Too many homicides, a lot of sliding. They good at making decks. Thanks to God, I made it out the city. Most would say I'm blessed. My greatest flex is that I made a milli. Feel like I'm Bangladesh. I hate the press, refusing interviews whenever they request. Niggas fake, progressive, and woke. I started saying less. I had to stop it. Peaked how they profit off of racial stress. Some activists got so rich they probably wish we stay oppressed. Studio steppers moving extra on songs faking rep. Only breaking bad in the lab. Thought y'all was making meth. Niggas making threats and I laugh. That's cause you ain't a threat. Don't ask how I feel about no rappers. Shit, they okay, I guess. Incoming car, press the button. The one to say accept. He FaceTimed to ask for a feature and saw the face of death. I'm on your song, your stream's going up. Not quite the Drake effect, but don't complain, bitch, take what you get and cut the label check. My table set, I died on your favorite. One verse will take his breath. I probably put more niggas on pause than Cam and Mason Beth. My agent get a whole lot of calls. It's like he paid the ref. These bitches out here looking like Steph on a late contest. Wide open, shooting they shot. Don't even waste your breath. I've been stopped fucking you dots. Ain't got no patience left. Say that shit for one of them niggas that rock the fake protects. My paper stress just like a Laker before he break a sweat. Sign, greatest yet. As for me, I cook so masterfully. Ain't gotta pay a chef. I'm older now, but still I'm cutting edge. I'm like a bayonet from Optiville. We OSHA certified. You gotta wear your vest. Too many homicides, a lot of sliding. They good at making decks. Thanks to God, I made it out the city. Most would say I'm blessed. My greatest flex is that I made a milli. Feel like I'm Bangladesh. I hate the press, refusing interviews whenever they request. Niggas fake, progressive, and woke. I started saying less. I had to stop it. Peaked how they profit off of racial stress. Some activists got so rich they probably wish we stay oppressed. Studio steppers moving extra on songs faking rep. Only breaking bad in the lab. Thought y'all was making meth. Niggas making threats and I laugh. That's cause you ain't a threat. Don't ask how I feel about no rappers. Shit, they okay, I guess. Incoming car, press the button. The one to say accept. He FaceTimed to ask for a feature and saw the face of death. I'm on your song, your stream's going up. Not quite the Drake effect, but don't complain, bitch, take what you get and cut the label check. My table set, I died on your favorite. One verse will take his breath. I probably put more niggas on pause than Cam and Mason Beth. My agent get a whole lot of calls. It's like he paid the ref. These bitches out here looking like Steph on a late contest. Wide open, shooting they shot. Don't even waste your breath. I've been stopped fucking you dots. Ain't got no patience left. Say that shit for one of them niggas that rock the fake protects. My paper stress just like a Laker before he break a sweat. Sign, the greatest yet. For me,
gay. That's crazy.
Gay. No? Okay, here's another. Gay. Gay. Okay, okay, I see what you're going for, but you shouldn't use that word like that. That's offensive. Gay. Yes, good, you got it. A. Gay. No? Okay, here's another. Gay. Gay. Okay, okay, I see what you're going for. It's out of the coconuts, the twist and the leaves. The island gives us what we
need.
What are you doing? I'm learning ASL with an app called Lingvano. I'm trying to keep my street. What's ASL? Oh, it's American...
Ops wanted...
All right. Y'all know what I want to listen to. I'm listening to all these reels and memes, and then I wanted to finish listening to... Is that a pimple? Damn, I think I thought I just felt something. I hate when I get a little pimple on my ear. Anyway... I want to finish listening to this presidential debate too. Not presidential, but Republican debate. And we're working on this pillow. Let's see if we can just go ahead and knock some more of these little details out in this pillowcase. And then. Pillowcase, and then the pants, I guess. I still really think about doing these pants last, but I probably want to do the books last. So, let's see if we can work on this pillow. I probably should drink some water. I haven't drunk anything since I got up this morning. Let's get this water in here. Let me try something real quick.
the mail, and you can now measure that in unemployment, in crime, in devastation. If you want to restore hope, you've got to restore the family, restore capitalism, and put Americans back at work together as one American family.
Is he supposed to represent the South?
To go in the right direction. It's why I can say I have been discriminated against, but America is not a racist country.
I've been racist. I've been discriminated against. They call me ER, but America ain't racist.
Needs a brand new leader, and I'm asking for your vote.
The debate literally asked him if he's been gotten told, particularly Ken.
7 million students in over 18,000 public schools nationwide have the ability to change their identity without parental notification.
Oh, here we go.
Governor Christie told Stewart last week that he would pass a federal law to protect.
They actually haven't talked about LGBTQ plus people at all yet, so.
Yeah.
I have to be very clear about this. Transgenderism, especially in kids, is a mental health disorder. We have to acknowledge the truth of that for what it is.
Going around DeSantis out of the gates.
On parental rights in school.
Parents have the right to know. And you know what the hypocrisy of this is? Even New Hampshire failed to actually get past a piece of legislation here. The very people who say that this increases the risk of suicide are also the ones saying that parents don't have the right to know about that increased risk of suicide. And I'm sorry, it is
it's
not
because of people like you that's the reason why. That's what all this stuff is. The science of data show.
Too, like,
this is cringe.
It's so fucking
outright fucking far right rhetoric.
Getting double mastectomies and a hysterectomy. One of them never have children. And the fact that we allowed that to happen in
education.
This country is barbaric, so I will ban genital mutilation or chemical castration.
Every major medical association in the U.S. disagrees with you.
Absolutely.
You're trying to pass a federal law that says parents should have that right.
We are going to require states absolutely have to follow that through. We stand for parental rights. Yes.
You, in your state, this is you do not have a law that says parents can be notified. But you want to be president. Would you try to pass a federal law to say parents have that right?
I think this is a state's issue, but I do want to say something, because all night long we've been talking about issues, about how it's broken in Washington, and I respect all of the people on the stage here for their 100-plus years of public service. But the reason why we're not talking about education or health care or safety being a problem in North Dakota is because we have a business leader. I've got more experience as a business leader than I think this whole country. You know, I've created more jobs than everybody else on stage, thousands of high-paying jobs that have real meaning. So as a business leader, you come in and you treat the taxpayer like a customer. So in North Dakota, instead of fighting with the teachers' unions, we actually created a K-12 coordinating council. Everybody gets in the room, and the customer is
but
the student.
But you do understand that this is an issue that many people in America really are concerned about, worried about parents and notification in schools.
This is a manufactured issue, thanks to Fox News.
That's why I have states. There are certain things the federal government is supposed to do. It's not the Department of Education that needs to be assembled. We've got to move it back to states. Do what we did in North Dakota. Instead of like, oh, here's a choice school and here's an old school, the old way with the teachers union, the kids are trapped. We made every school in North Dakota an innovation school. Every school got out from under the red tape. And the things that help teach the values that we're trying to get, like 4-H, like FFA, like boys' college, they can get credit for all of that stuff. And by the way, North Dakota is now at the top of the median SAT scores in the country right now.
Fine. Humans are noisy. They thrive on chaos. They like to make things. It gives them meaning. They do it over and over and over again until they shut down. Humans are fueled by inspiration. Inspiration and something called tacos. Change makes them nervous, but embracing it changes everything. Yeah, imagine that.
Vice President Pence, the Department of Homeland Security warns that violence against LGBTQ plus people is on the rise and intensifying. According to a recent study, members of that community are 9 times more likely to be victims of violent hate crimes. As president, how would you protect this community from violent attacks.
I would not.
Yeah. This dude with all his HIV hysteria, are you kidding me?
And the civil liberties of every American, from every background. And I want the American people to know that.
What about civil rights?
But I want to answer the question.
That's the question.
I don't want to talk about this, because my answer is that gay conversion therapy. No more gays. No more harassment against gays.
Yeah.
My wife isn't a member of the teachers union, but I got to admit, I've been sleeping with a teacher for 38 years.
What?
Why would you say it like that?
Education is
What? I've been fucking a teacher.
What the? That was so weird. See her in the audience?
I don't think that's what he meant to
I'm
say.
Hitting that.
Listen, she bends me over the desk and takes a ruler, and let me tell you.
You had to have a permission slip from your parents to get a Tylenol, but you could get a gender transition plan without notifying your parents.
Stop. That's not what happened.
That's not true.
Transgender, chemical, or surgical surgery anywhere in the country. We've got to protect.
What about circumcision?
From this radical gender.
Or surgeries on intersex babies.
And we've got to empower parents at the state level.
Yeah.
With the ability to choose where the kids go to school, whether it's public, private, parochial, or homeschool, you empower parents, and our schools will straighten up and reflect our values.
Straighten up.
Oh my God. Literally straighten up.
Possibly imagine.
Yeah. This is why we talk over these people. It's better.
Yeah.
It's better than listening to them. I mean, especially when they're going into fucking fascism. Yeah, it's just like, it's enough.
China is investing heavily in their tech companies. $280 billion every year on.
Thank God we moved on from LGBTQ issues. It's just
act per year. The vague was so bad.
You say
companies like Google and Meta have too much power. Doesn't going after them give China an edge?
No, I think you look at how our societies develop. They have huge amount of power over our society. They've cracked down on free speech.
Yo, he was up,
saying you don't want them to do business, but you want them to be a free market. And right now, they're monopolies. But this issue of China, I think, is really going to be fundamental. We have subcontracted out so much of our national needs to the CCP. We rely on them for a whole host of issues. We need to reshore and we need to decouple all those important industries. We need to get that back in the United States. They are our top geopolitical adversary by a country mile. Xi Jinping's got huge ambitions, not only in the Asia Pacific, but as you mentioned earlier, in our region. But ultimately, we've got to beat him on the economy. And so that's what we'll do as president of the United States.
Governor Christie, I wanted to follow up on this because 22% of American workers fear their jobs will be lost to a robot. And you said in the past that the free market is. Would you retrain workers to artificial intelligence and to do what?
Crawling around.
Well, look, what I think artificial intelligence.
I kind of crawled out of bed this morning. I did leg day yesterday, bro. Well, my legs hurt that we have now. So bad. I don't know. Like, my legs aren't normally this sore like this. Well, I haven't been taking my my protein shit either. But I don't know if that's my shit feels crazy.
And we should have more training available both at the county college level and the local level for people to be able to access it. So, yes, I would be in favor of that. But this is a much bigger issue than that. We can't be afraid of innovation. America has been the great innovator of this world over the last 250 years. A technological innovator, a manufacturing innovator, and a freedom and governmental innovator. And that's why America has to continue to stand strong in the world, pro-innovation, pro-progress. And I will tell you this, as President of the United States, what I will do is to make sure that every innovator in this country...
So, it's not what it can do, but how this motherfucker is built. My bad, bro. I should really just do this later. I'm actually, took 2 hours of warm up. Like, nah, nigga. I'm trying to write an artist statement for, my upcoming show. I'm not trying to write an artist statement. I'm trying to get ChatGPT to write an artist statement for me. Tensor and statistics. What the fuck? Bro, they say, that shit can see now. You can input images into, GPT. And you can talk to this motherfucker now. Say, be careful though. All right, I'm coming. All right, I'm almost done. I swear to God, I'm almost done. See what the fuck this shit does. Alright, I got that. It only took me fucking 30 minutes with help, but it sounds good. I just gotta edit it down. Man, Chris Christie, Vivek Ramaswamy, man, like, I don't trust none of these people, honestly. Ouch. No. Mike Pence, Tim Scott, this other motherfucker, I don't even know who the fuck, what the fuck, who the fuck this dude is, or where the fuck this dude from?
government the hell off its back and out of its pocket so that it can innovate and bring great new inventions to our country that will make everybody's lives better.
Folks, our fundraising deadline is coming up, and I need your support to reach our goal. You know, I hate asking, but the strength of this grassroots-driven campaign depends on you. And that's not a joke. That's not an exaggeration. Whatever you can give today will go much further than the same donation later on. So, we have a lot of work ahead of us. We have to finish the job. And with this team by my side, I know we will. So chip in today. Let's get it done.
Here we have an average Joe drinking an average Joe.
Yeah, that checks out.
Boring basic coffee is leaving you dead inside. Thank the Dark Lord, there's Bones Coffee. Small batch, full-bodied coffee infused with the most mind-melting flavors in the world. Or underworld.
Oh, I've had flavored coffee
before. Oh, I've had vegan coffee before. You haven't had Welcome. To the highly caffeinated, slightly wicked, and immortally delicious world of Bones. Our mad coffee scientists have twisted nature to their demented will. With frightfully delicious flavors like From Dusk Till Donuts.
It's a taste I can really sink my teeth in.
Mitten Vaders.
I don't mean to probe, but how did you make this coffee taste like ice cream?
An electric unicorn.
Like eating fruity cereal.
Yeah! At Bones Coffee, we'll try just about every flavor combo out there.
Cannolis, salted pretzels, strawberry cheesecake.
The ones we love are made into small batches, roasted to order, and delivered directly to you. But the others... Rest in peace, Beanfish. We've got over 30 killer concoctions. So French press that link to find your new flavored coffee. There's more to life than pumpkin spice. But yeah, we smash that pumpkin too. We also have comforting classic coffee if the flavored stuff is too scary. At Bones, our beans are complex and multidimensional.
Yo, this is crazy.
I have opinions.
I just had this shit right here. This is why I be getting stuck on my fucking phone.
Stop drinking hot bean water and resurrect your caffeine routine. You can...
Mr. Ramaswamy.
Yo, this shit right here just said... 11-year-old girl... has earned more... than $21 million with her business and is set to retire in a couple of years. Pixie Curtis has already made $21 million at just 11 years old, all through the power of Instagram and high income skills. But how is that possible? But when they say high income skills, it's her at 11 taking this really adult pose and getting on a private jet. Like, I don't know. Pixie's Instagram account is a result of the major shift we are going through right now. The economy is changing real time. And people with remote high income skills are building generation wealth. What the fuck is a high income skill? Bitch, you're sitting here just looking cute. That's what you're trying to do. And looking older than your age is the thing that gets me. And somehow your Instagram has made you $21 million. I wonder why.
Me? I'm the Riddler. I'm not racist. I'm not here to solve the mother of all riddles. Riddle me this before you go. I am loud and obnoxious. I like music and rhymes. I'm a fraction of the population, but commit half the crimes. Whoever.
Oh, you sound like you might be a little bit racist.
Me? I'm the Riddler. I'm not racist. I'm not here to solve the mother of all riddles. Riddle me this before you go. I am loud and obnoxious. I like music that rhymes. I'm a fraction of the population, but commit half the crimes. Who am I?
Wow. And then the comments on some shit just be like, ugh. All right, whatever.
TikTok is banned on government-issued devices because of its ties to the Chinese government. Yet you join TikTok after dinner with boxer and influencer Jake Paul.
And allegedly,
chief, be so easily persuaded by influencer.
So the answer is I have a radical idea for the Republican Party. We need to win elections. And part of how we win elections is reaching the next generation of young Americans.
And telling them they can't fucking vote.
That's so true.
We're only going to ever get to declaring independence from China, which I favor, if we actually win. So while the Democrats are running rampant, reaching the next generation...
Someone should bring that up.
There's exactly one person in the Republican Party which talks a big game about reaching young people, and that's me. And let me level with all of you. I'm the new guy here, and so I know I have to earn your trust. What do you see? You see a young man who's in a bit of a hurry.
Oh, my God.
Maybe a little ambitious. Wow. Bit of a know-it-all, it seems, at times. I'm here to tell you, no, I don't know it all. I will listen. I will have the
Russell looks like Butthead from Beavis and Butthead.
Damn, I can't unsee it now. He's a fucking Indian.
That's how I built my company.
Beavis.
I want to be challenged. I want people who disagree with me. That's
I mean,
what makes
Butthead, yeah,
goddamn.
Perfect
nation. We're founded on the pursuit of perfection. That is what makes America.
Someone yelling in the background?
Mike Pence is yelling at him, yeah.
Where's Mike? iPad. Oh, shit. I just noticed this whole time my iPad ain't even up here. All right.
Because TikTok is one of the most dangerous social media apps that we could have. And what you've got, I honestly, every time I hear you, I feel a little bit dumber for what you say.
Oh. Goddamn,
burn.
Here goes that Donald Duck comment.
150 million people are on TikTok. That means they can get your contacts, they can get your financial information, they can get your emails, they can get your text messages, they can get all of
these
things. China knows exactly what they're doing. And what we see is you've gone and you've helped China build make medicines in China, not America. You
know, no, you let her speak.
You're on the social media that's dangerous for all of us. You went and you were in business with the Chinese that gave Hunter Biden $5 million.
Oh.
We can't trust you.
I am crushing it right now.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
You have 15 seconds, Mr. Ramaswamy. Thank you. I think we would be better served as a Republican Party if we're not sitting here hurling personal insults
and actually have a legitimate debate about policy following Reagan's 11th Amendment in his honor. And the answer is, that is what actually makes our country strong. I believe in these people. These are good people on this stage.
Is it all over TikTok?
Isn't it inspiring to see two, Indian Americans reach this stage where they can talk about pulling up the ladder to everyone who's coming up behind them after their immigrant parents came to this country? It's amazing.
This is fine. ...work with China to force our decline. President Reagan believed that if you want to prevent a war...
What is that?
What is your face doing? Yeah. Bobblehead.
Look at his mouth.
He's grinding
his teeth. Yeah.
He does that often.
He does. Russia's military for less than 5% of what we pay annually on defense, especially when there are no U.S. soldiers in the fight.
It's in our interest to end this war, and that's what I will do as president. We are not going to have a blank check. We will not have U.S. troops. And we're going to make the Europeans do what they need to do. But they've sent money to pay bureaucrats' pensions and salaries and funding small businesses halfway around the world. Meanwhile,
all right. Yeah, I don't know why I didn't bring my iPad up. I was like, yo, what the hell?
We have got to defend the American people.
Is it charged? Thank God it has some charge on it. I took it to work with me yesterday because I was hoping if I had like a free minute or two, I could work on something. One of my homies want me to do a logo for, like, yo, I'm getting so many logo requests recently, but my homeboy just started a business and he wants something for his company, and I was like, eh, I got you, bro. So I was like, well, if I take my iPad to work, I was like, if I get like a free minute or something, I might try to pop on Canva or just, you know, research like some popular logos or something. Because I hate doing too much personal stuff on my, on any of my work devices. Except this. This laptop is actually like my work laptop. But it really, only thing I do on here is YouTube, mostly. Because I don't download anything, or I don't go to any kind of weird websites or order anything through this shit, like even Amazon or nothing. Like, I don't do really nothing on this laptop itself. What I'm doing with it now. Yeah, there was so my friend Mickey. Let me know about this event. And I think I heard about it because I get the email sometimes, but I kind of brush it off because I'm not like, I don't know. Anyway, I'm pretty sure I saw the email and I was like, and then my, one of my coworkers, she mentioned the event. She was like, oh, are you going to go to Helen's opening on Friday? I'm like, Helen always, she does hers like right before First Friday instead of doing it on First Friday. But I think it's a smart tactic because she gets the whole crowd because no, there's nothing else going on. And so I was like, maybe. And then, man, the art buddies were in the chat, and they were like, are you going to Nikki's? I'm like, not Nikki, Helen. So I actually hung out last night, and I seen, like, some of my other coworkers there. It was a good time. But, I don't know. But the curator of the show, oh, she probably posted. We took a really good picture together, too. She wanted a picture of us. And because everybody kind of knows our little art clique. Like, we're the, like, the cool artists, I guess. And, like, Helen's show last night is really good, too. It's a really good show. But they're, like, you know, the more seasoned artists, like, the vets. And we're, like, the older guys. And so my art clique, we're, like, we're not young people, but we're not the motherfuckers who grandfathered into this shit around here, so... And that's why we try to really stick together and promote each other's shows and kind of just, you know, hang out and make sure, like, when we do have shows that we show up for each other and shit like that. So I already know, like, my show in December, just because we've had our little art clique for about a year now. So this first Friday, there's two of them have shows. And then I think somebody has a show in November, and then I have my show in December, and then last night the curator for Helen's spot asked our art group if we wanted our own show at Helen's sometime at the beginning of the year. And then I didn't know she worked over here in Luzerne County with the college, and she asked if I would talk to the art students sometime coming up. I'm like, hell yeah. And some dude approached me too. He was an older gentleman with a nice little gray suit on. He's like, excuse me, are you the young man who does the really, like, the detailed paintings? It's like African American culture with the books. I'm like, yes, sir, that's me. And he's like, I tried to contact you a couple times and you never respond. I'm like, really? I was like, how? He's like, on your email. I tried to email you. You never respond. I know you do, like, bigger paintings, but I want something small, you know? If you can, I want to commission you for a small painting. I can get you a small painting, sir. Just email me again. Make sure it's the right email. So I gave him the card. I gave him my card again. Like, make sure it's the right email, because now I may need to check my spam more often, because I had someone who wanted to interview me for a magazine that they were doing, and we were supposed to set up a Zoom meeting, and she was like, oh, I'll send you the link via email, and the day and time of, I never got that shit. And then, like, hours later in the day, I looked back to see if she communicated saying, oh, I forgot, or I did this, or I did that, and there still wasn't any emails. And I was like, check my spam. And the motherfucking Zoom link was in my fucking spam. So, I don't know why I've never seen this guy's email or how long he's been trying to reach out to get a commissioned painting done, but we'll see. And, I was going somewhere. Where the fuck was I? I was going to the dentist, and I passed by this little fucking gallery. NEPA gallery, and that shit's not far from my house, bro. Like, I was like, what? And it's on, like, it's so weird, it's like on a residential street. This shit should be like a fucking bodega or some shit like that, like a corner store or something. And they turned that shit into a goddamn gallery, which is pretty cool. All right, so I was going to the dentist, and I'm driving, and I And this is a street that I know. That's why this shit looks new, because the whole front of the building looks freshened up and like all this shit is new. So I was like, oh, damn. We got a little gallery here. Shout out my little kids. Little after school program with the little kids. I asked for one more volunteer because, like, even we got, you know what? I didn't notice this chick right here has her hands in her pocket. And they asked me how she did, because she seems like she don't want to do this, honestly. Look, engage with the kids. She's engaged. This is our homework helping session. We just happen to be outside. So she's helping. She's all the way down on eye level. She's eye level with this kid, right? Helping. She's engaging with her, trying to get her prepared. And so there's still, so that's two kids. There's another kid right there. And there's someone else here. But see, me and my man's right here. This is kind of like our drone. So me taking pictures and him having his hands is okay. You're just trying to watch and see how the volunteers help out. They all did. I think she actually did come around towards the end. Start helping out more. But in the beginning, like, you got to get right in there and help. But this is where she wanted to help, is more like with crafts and stuff instead of the homework. And I get it. Homework be kind of boring with the kids sometimes, but because it's, I don't know, it's not really boring. I get excited. I helped the one kid read a story. He had this long ass story he had to read. Where he at? I can't think of his name either. Oh, I think he came up later. But he had this long ass story to read. And so we read this story with him, and he was the last. We were really just waiting on him to get finished reading so we can start the project. But I don't know, man. They had, like, he only in first grade. They had, like, a couple of words up there. I was like, is a first grader even know this shit? Some shit was like, I can't think of the one word when he. I was looking at shit like, I mean, it's good that they're stacking it, but like, you expect him to, well, I guess not, because I guess you expect the child to get help from the parents, but I don't know, like, there was like two or three words up there. I remember one was like pizzazz, and I get it, like, trying to sound it out, but this motherfucker don't know what pizzazz is. I was like, what the hell? But then at the same time, that's the learning instant right there, where you teach him a new word. And pizzazz means kind of dazzly or ritzy or with excitement, you know? Pizzazz. I was like, okay, with the story time. Oh, this is good. So we all made these rockets. You can see his the best. That's the one who had to read the story too. But he got his rocket. And we made these little launchers with rubber bands, so you just pull it back and shoot that bad boy. Yeah, he just went the farthest too. He had to run all the way. I think he just went all the way down there. yeah. We'll be having fun. Go here, we go here. Let's see if we can zoom in on this pillow. All right.
He does not want to have to talk. He's so entitled.
The resources that we send over to Ukraine is guaranteed to say loan. It is not at 90% of the money that we send over there is loan. Well, we can talk about this, but at the end of the day, 90% of the money that we send over there is actually paid by loan. It's not actually not being paid by Ukraine. It's paid by the NATO, our NATO allies.
So I think it's a good topic.
I will say, let's debate the fact that
why is he jumping in?
National vital interest is in degrading the Russian military. By degrading the Russian military, we actually keep our homeland safer, we keep our troops at home, and we all understand Article 5 of NATO.
We have to level with the American people.
I thought you said something about waiting until your turn to talk.
Okay.
So at the end of the day,
here you go.
I'll look forward to this one right now. So at the end of the day, when you think about the fact that you want to keep American troops at home, attack on NATO territory would bring us and our troops in. By degrading the Russian military, we reduce, if not eliminate, an attack.
Level
with the American people. We have to level with the American people on this issue. The reality is just because Putin is not Putin's an evil dictator does not mean that Ukraine is good. This is a country that has banned the opposition parties.
A win
that
for has Russia actually, is a
that
win
is not
for
true.
China.
We're driving
a win
Russia.
For Russia is
excuse
a
me.
Win
ex-
for
excuse
China.
Me. You have
but
a chance.
I forgot. You like
you'll
China.
Have,
that's
no,
why
you,
you're
you'll have your chance.
It's getting spicy
China's
with the.
Yeah. And we're driving Russia further into China's arms. We need a reasonable peace plan to end this. Especially, this is a country whose president just last week
Vivek,
was hailing
let Putin attack Ukraine. That's a green light to China to take Taiwan.
We need
peace comes through strength.
What a mess this whole thing is. This is everybody's. I don't know. I think they're all actors. They just got different fucking talking points that they feel like could get them in there. But I think that a peaceful resolution is the best thing. A win for Russia is a win for China. Look, man, this has been y'all own doing for fucking generations now. So if these motherfuckers gonna win, they're gonna win economically. And that's what you're scared of with, access to drugs and like the components used to make different drugs and medications, whether it's losing out on a major portion of the oil industry, losing out on major parts of just the global economy in general. And this is what's going to happen, and it's because you put your own fucking selves here, and oh, it's going to be a win for China. No, China's going to fucking win regardless of what we do. You're just trying to stalemate this shit longer instead of coming up with different strategies to really reinvigorate our economy and the way our capitalistic system is structured. But no, what they're going to do is, what they're trying to do now is bankrupt us militarily, lose face globally. Ooh, damn. don't even know where that motherfucker fell to. Ouch, ow, goddamn. Can I reach this? Need to get some snacks close by. Aw, damn, I drank that whole bottle of water. I might have to grab another water, too.
China, Russia, and Iran closer together. Are we focused too much on Ukraine and not enough on this threat from the New World Order?
No, they're all connected, Stuart. Mm. They're all connected.
Hulk Hogan, Kevin Nash, Scott Hall, X-Pac. New World Order is coming in strong. They've been around for years.
The North Koreans now as well.
For life!
The naivete on the stage from some of these folks is extraordinary. Look. I understand people want to go and talk to Putin. Guess what? So did George W. Bush. So did Barack Obama. So did Donald Trump. And so did Joe Biden when he said a small invasion wouldn't be so bad. Every one of them has been wrong. And the fact of the matter is, we need to say right now that the Chinese-Russian alliance is something we have to fight against, and we are not going to solve it by going over and cuddling up to Vladimir Putin. Look. Donald Trump said Vladimir Putin was brilliant and a great leader. This is the person who is murdering people in his own country, and now not having enough blood, he's now going to Ukraine to murder innocent civilians and kidnap 20,000 children. And let me tell you, if you think that's where it's going to stop, if we give him any of Ukraine, next will be Poland. This is a guy who said, wait, one sec, this is a guy in 1991 who said that was the darkest moment in world's history when the Soviet Union fell. Listen, everybody, he wants to put the old band back together, and only America can stop it. And when I'm president, we will.
Put the war, war, war.
He wants to put the old band back there. What, are you resurrecting Stalin? Is he bringing back the
Lenin rises.
Because there is a foreign policy connection here. The U.S. and China are in this fierce economic competition. It's hurting American businesses. And
economics.
There is blowback against American farmers because China then targets them in retaliation. How would you, as president, protect American farmers and ranchers from that kind of retaliation from a foreign government like China?
Well, first of all, we've got the best farmers and ranchers in the world right here in America. If they have a level playing field, they can outcompete.
That's a fucking lie. We don't have the best farmers and ranchers. Most of our farming and cattle, our beef production, is mechanized by large corporations. Huge businesses. They make it sound like the farmer is still Jim and his son out there on a horse with their dog. Those aren't the farmers that supply the bulk of our fucking food. The bulk of our food comes from these fucking mechanized large operations that are mostly ran by illegal immigrants. This all is for entertainment purposes only. This is scripted, and I have no clue what the fuck I'm talking about.
World, but this is part of the larger issue that we're talking about here, which is we're in a Cold War with China. The Biden administration won't admit that. We're also in an economic war through what we're doing with agriculture and energy, and we're also in a war with them relative to cyber war. We get attacked every day in North Dakota, every state, every school district, our tribes all being attacked every day by either China, Russia, Iran, or North Korea. And now we've got a Biden administration whose whole policy is appeasement. They're out there, you know, creating the world, making it less safe. $6 billion they traded for five people. They just now set a price on anyone's head who's a tourist from America, who's a student from America, for kidnapping. If you want more kidnapping, put a price on it. And then that's, and they're also helping Iran get to have more
about.
Closer to nuclear weapons. Which
I'm like tuning out, really.
The crowd on this has been dead, too.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
like,
yeah, they have.
I'm not even seeing that many people talk about it online, like they did the first debate.
Less successful
because they knew what they said. That they're going to get to that in parts of it.
Because China imports 10 million barrels of
oil. I hate all that clapping they do, though. I think that sounds so fake.
Like 96.
Yeah, exactly.
Policy, which is making the world less stable, it's empowering dictators. It's not about climate change that we need worried about. It's about the Biden climate policies that are actually the existential threat to America's future.
Is he done now? Jesus Christ.
He needs to just
stop.
Sending U.S. military into the country.
I refuse to believe that guy somehow makes the debate stage. True.
There's no way.
Did you
not
say he paid for his
security? You say you will send special operations to attack the cartels in Mexico. So, this means boots on the ground? Drone strikes?
It means special operations. It's how we deal with our terrorists. And what you need to do is understand that Mexico's not being a good partner if we lost 75,000 Americans last year. Mexico's not.
So you can do military operations in the country, in a sovereign fucking country.
What we will do is we will make sure that we send in our special operations and we will take
out
the cartels, we'll take out anything that's doing it. But we're going to go after China because China is the one.
Militarily, or because I'm not sure at this point.
Yeah, I'm not understanding. So you're going to send in your special operations into Mexico to help take out the cartels? So, I don't know. Why does this just sound like invasion? You're going to invade Mexico, right? But everyone keeps screaming that China is the biggest threat. You know, yeah, the borders is an issue, and we need to get that together. But China. But we're going to invade Mexico. Why don't you fucking invade China? Why don't you go do that shit over there? Mexicans are actually Americans too, man. It's weird that most Americans think the United States is America, the continent. Canada, Alaska, Mexico, all that shit is still North America. It's America, still. We're still all on the same big-ass fucking landmass. Your solution. Invade Mexico. Wow. Okay. Hey, wait, see how this shit play out.
Until China stops sending fentanyl, and then we'll do the special.
Good luck with that.
Everyone's sending fentanyl. Fentanyl from left, from the right, from the bottom, from the top.
Not here, though. America is not, because they don't want to be fentanyl with everybody else that brings it.
They were stealing $600 billion in intellectual property. He didn't focus on the fact that they put a spy base off our shores in Cuba. They didn't focus enough on the fact that all of our law enforcement drones in America are Chinese, and we've got all these little surveillance cells. We need to start focusing on what keeps Americans safe.
And surveillance them.
As your president, I will make sure every American is safe, and we'll do whatever it takes to make that happen. All right. I want to get to Senator Scott.
Want to register for an LLC in 4 easy steps? I got you. Go to Taylor Brands and let's officially form your business. Step 1, choose the state you want to run your business in. I'm choosing Jersey. Step 2, enter your business name to check if it's available. My business name, Bulldog Boutique. Yay, it is! Step 3, answer a few quick questions about your biz.
You're all auditioning for the job as President of the United States. You want to earn these votes. But the world's problems land in the Oval Office. During the presidential debates in the year 2000, neither Al Gore nor George W. Bush was asked about Al-Qaeda. Yet, just 1 year later, Al-Qaeda's attack on September 11th claimed nearly 3,000 lives. And the farther we get from September 11th, the closer we are to September 10th. Senator Scott, you have no executive branch experience. What has prepared you to protect the nation from a major man-made national security crisis?
One of the things I've had the good fortune of doing is serving on committees in the United States Senate, like the Senate Armed Services Committee. I'm on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, also on the Finance Committee and the Banking Committee. Talk about addressing the issue of fentanyl. I've written the legislation, passed it through the Banking Committee and the Senate, that freeze the assets and sanction the accounts of the Mexican cartels. There are weapons that we have within the arsenal that I was able to get past 23-0 in the polarizing Senate as it is. I've also understood without question the fact that if you look at the details before 9/11, there was information and intelligence that was available. that suggested an attack was coming. Having the right intelligence partners with us is key to making sure that we prevent the next 9/11 from ever happening. Having that experience for the last 10 years is really important in getting the job done.
30 seconds to you, Mr. Pence.
Well, I think you asked a question about executive experience, and I think it's vitally important. And I stand before you today as a candidate for president because I think this country's in a lot of trouble. And you hear the fire on the stage tonight.
It's so overly dramatic. I can't understand it. Right. Jesus Christ.
Country at home.
So fake. Abroad.
This is a time for those of
us who have the experience,
the tested experience, and a commitment to the conservative agenda that Ronald Reagan brought forward in this party, of a strong national defense, standing with our allies, standing up to our enemies, supporting limited government and traditional
amnesty. Oh,
to step forward.
Understood.
Because frankly, our party does face a time for choosing, as they said at the top of this debate, whether we're going to stand on the foundation of that conservative agenda that Ronald Reagan poured, or whether we're going to follow the siren songs of populism unmoored to conservative principles. I'm the most experienced, most qualified, and most consistent conservative in this field, and I'm ready to lead America at home and abroad on day one.
Time for choosing to go to a break. Ilya.
We need to go to a commercial break where Reagan built a coalition that lasted decades. Can any of these candidates do the same? We'll take that up when the debate continues.
No. The answer is no.
So I read that Perino, the blonde moderator, was George W. Bush's 26th press secretary.
Yes.
Doesn't 26 seem high? Like, wow. I know he served two terms, but how many do they have on average? Like two or three,
that's
right?
That's 26, really? I didn't know that.
What?
Well, I read it. I mean, who knows if it's true, but I read it today. And I was like, that's shocking.
That doesn't sound right. Like, right? What, a month or something? Like,
I'll check it. I'll check it now.
It's crazy.
Seven.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so she was six.
Was she 26? Maybe she was 26 years old.
I wouldn't be surprised.
She was the 26th, I believe, in total, like, of all press secretaries, I want to say.
Okay.
Is there an author who was the 26th White House press secretary under George W. Bush? So she was just the...
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had to.
The way it's written, to run that sounds value. Like it's like the 26th.
Right, it's a little bit confusing, yeah. Because that'd be a higher turnover rate than Donald Trump's administration, which would be quite the feat. Yeah, this debate is very, very bad. It's I don't think that any of them are even close to matching Trump.
I thought the other one was wrong.
Sorry.
There was four press secretaries.
Okay. But I mean, like, none of them are going to pass Trump. This is also pointless. And I think that it is really smart.
Yeah,
it's smart for Christie to try to goad Trump into
here?
These
Why
debates. It's not going to work. Yeah, this is all such a waste of time, so useless. Only 3,400 people are watching. Nobody cares. We should just go home.
Last time was like 20,000. That shows you the drop-off. How
right.
People are just like, they watch the first time because they're curious, like, what the hell's going to go on. And then they saw, oh, yeah, it's this shit again. And then they
I've seen it back.
Interesting. It's not. They know what to expect. No one's going to answer questions directly. People are going to argue with each other. We know. I'm surprised Vivek didn't get more. He wasn't as hot as he was in the first debate. With his punchlines and his obsession with talking points from Twitter or X, but I'm surprised he didn't come out with that. But just seeing how, like, everyone is on the same wavelength, except for Haley, who's answering questions as they're being asked. Now,
education questions for sure. Stats. A lot of this is actually accurate. Yeah.
And even with that, when they were speaking education, all of them wanted to bring up parenting. And then how does that go into kids being transgender or whatever? They really were going left field. And this is what we see them do on a regular. Republicans, what we see them do. Kids dying, getting shot up. They don't want to talk about that. They'll go to LGBTQIA, drag queens, all that stuff, how that is an issue. Not how the state itself is, like in Georgia. There's a TikTok that's going viral about the kids not being, not getting passed up
at like lower levels, but they're still, the state is telling them to pass them anyway. And it's the state also. I blame parents too, but the state, the laws are allowing you guys to put kids that can't even, don't even have basic functioning skills, and to go, like, they're in third grade, but they're in like kindergarten stage. They're in like, they're seniors and they're on sixth grade reading levels, but the state is telling you to go ahead and pass them. That's problematic. So if our leaders are not giving the correct answers and trying to figure out where they're going to put the blame, it just, except for on what, how these states have now have passed laws where it, you can't even, if a kid is acting out in class, you can't even tell them a thing about how they're, you know, you can't even reprimand them. They're telling you, you can't do that. You're going to have to pass bad behavior and dumb. And
we've got a lot more issues to cover, a lot more questions to go, so let's dive right back in. We're here in California, where gas is nearing $6 a gallon, oil is close to $100 a barrel again. You say, drill, baby, drill. But the courts won't let you. Mr. Ramaswamy, how would you bring down prices without immediate drilling?
Well, look, I think that we do have to run through the courts and get through that administrative state to make sure we're using the natural resources here at home. And here's the other thing that we can do that's easy.
Forever, Mr. Ramaswamy.
And it addresses the national debt as well as brings down prices. Put people back to work. We are using taxpayer money to pay people more to stay at home than to go to work.
Oh, welfare is not yes. That'll solve the energy crisis. Welfare is simply
wow.
Eating fudge rounds.
Maybe wages are too low. Is that maybe the problem there?
In its place. This is an agency that has gone rogue. So in January 2026, when I have the opportunity as our next commander-in-chief, we will have a new chairman of the Federal Reserve who places priority on dollar stability, and then most importantly, send packing 75%
of the you ain't gonna state. Do shit with
reduce
the
federal employee headcount by 75%. Rescind 50% of unconstitutional federal regulations that are shackling businesses, both large and small. I've offered a very clear, practical plan to do it. That's how we unleash the economy. That's how we revive the integrity of a three-branch constitutional republic, rather than this technocracy of aristocracy.
I think one of the signature accomplishments of our administration was in just a few short years. We achieved energy independence. We became a net exporter of energy for the first time in 75 years. But on day one, Joe Biden declared a war on energy, which was no surprise because when Joe Biden ran for president, he said he was going to end fossil fuels. And they've been working overtime to do that ever since. If I'm president of the United States, we're going to open up federal lands. We're going to unleash American energy. We're going to have an all-of-the-above energy strategy. And I have a plan that actually would not only reclaim energy independence, but in 2006, America lost our position as the leading energy producer on Earth. I believe in the next 10 years, with the right policies and experienced leadership in the White House, we can reclaim our role as the leading energy producer on Earth, and that'll grow the American economy for generations to come.
I need your help solving a murder.
Who's murder?
Mine.
My name is Alec Mercer. I'm
okay,
a pro.
Mercer.
Governor Haley, reaction to that vote.
Person of leading an energy state, could I answer the energy question? No, Governor Haley. What I saw energy security is national security. We need a president that understands we have to partner with our producers and make sure that we have their backs. What you don't need is a president who is against energy independence. Ron DeSantis is against
this is bullshit about energy independence. How about you actually own? How about you own the oil? How about that? There's a plan. Like, these corporations don't give a fuck. It's just this idea that this is like independence.
Look at his face.
And you took green subsidies that you didn't have to take.
Governor DeSantis, you mentioned you have the right to respond 30 seconds.
Yeah.
I just did a plan out in West Texas for American energy dominance. We're going to choose Midland over Moscow. We're going to choose the Marcellus over the Mullahs. And we're going to choose Bakken over Beijing. And we are going to lower your gas prices. We are going to get that job done because it's important for our national security. It's important for jobs. And that's one of the best ways to drive down inflation.
Governor DeSantis. Governor DeSantis. This question is for you.
Our voters enacted a constitutional amendment.
You banned it before they voted.
Doesn't allow. No, it's not true.
You banned it before they voted. And not only that,
they
didn't vote on fracking.
She's totally wrong. They voted it in. That's what we did. Onshore, we do it in Florida. We don't have as much as maybe West Texas, but we do it. But that was a constitutional amendment. So that's just wrong. And let's just get real here. My plan will get the job done. We are going to be energy dominant, and that's what's going to happen.
Haley's on the offense.
Yeah, she's probably not the kind that I'd say.
Yeah, I think so too. Excuse me, we cannot talk over each other. We must respect each other's time.
That's all you've done.
This guy.
This is your
the
question.
British way.
The Biden administration is hell-bent on student loan forgiveness. But you say colleges should be on the hook when graduates cannot pay their debt. How does that address the cost of college? How does that the cost of college itself?
Because the colleges are going to have to make a decision. Do we offer? Do we expand the gender studies department? No one.
Oh, shut the fuck up.
They're going to focus on the things that really matter. They're going to make different choices. They're going to try to graduate people in 4 years. I also just want to come back to something Dana asked last segment about 9/11, because I was just at the 9/11 memorial with the families, my wife and I were by. It was very touching to be there, and it affected my life because I ended up joining the military as a result of that.
And he tortured people.
Minimum to be
the torture whisperer.
Yep. I ended up getting through Yale and Harvard Law School and somehow came out more conservative than when I went in, and that is not easy to do. Had a lot of opportunities to make
money.
I wanted to serve, and I'll never forget coming back on the plane from Iraq, landing in Coronado, California, North Island, and feeling that breeze off the Pacific Ocean, say, you know what? I am lucky to have been born in America.
The story.
And I think being able to serve, and I'll be the first president elected since 1988 who's actually served overseas in a war, I think that's going to help me as commander-in-chief to know how you see these issues and understand that there are real lives at stake for people that wear the uniform.
And we know that Governor Haley's husband is serving right now as well, and we thank him for that. Senator Scott, the national debt has nearly doubled in your time in office. The approval rate for Congress is at a mere 19%. If this were to be
not a mere,
you probably are tired, but you're here tonight looking for promotion. In 2013, Governor Haley hired you for the Senate. I'd like you to tell her why you should be promoted to CEO of the nation instead of her.
Certainly. One of the things I'd say is if you look at our national debt of $33 trillion, I would love to have an opportunity to have this country pass a balanced budget amendment that would constrain the spending in Washington in the same fashion that it does in every state in our nation, number one. Number two, if you want to actually reduce our national debt, you have to grow our economy. In order to grow our economy, you need to create about 10 million jobs to grow our economy at 5%. You can do that in three specific sectors. Number one, the energy sector. We could create between 3 and 3.5 million jobs if we unleash all of our energy resources. America is the most, we're the richest country if you combine coal, gas, and oil. Why not unleash all of our resources? Number two, we've lost 100,000 factories. 100,000 factories in the last 25 years. If we continued on my Made in America plan, we could bring jobs back to America in a similar fashion that we did when I wrote the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. We actually lowered the corporate tax from 35% to 21%, reshored or repatriated $1.7 trillion. We brought the unemployment rates for African Americans, Hispanics, and Asians.
You know, once you said African American, they would come with a ding ding ding.
I appreciate Tim. We've known each other a long time, but he's been there 12 years and he hasn't done any of that. He
hasn't
given four budgets on time in 40
years. Love you mean it, but
he increased the national debt. He voted for the spending. He has made sure that the poor are helping and they haven't done anything. He's looking at everything he's done. 12 years. Where have you been? Where have you been, Tim? 12 years. We've waited and nothing has happened.
Here's what you
Oh, now he's being dragged.
The things they're saying. I'm the only one up here who's gotten in the big
fights
and has delivered big victories for the people of Florida. And that's what it's
housing wokeness. The cost of housing grows the most in Florida and the other state. Doing a fantastic job there.
Most people losing health insurance in the nation.
Great. What a great state.
Because of our success, the Democratic Party lies in ruins. We have won the big fights. We have turned our state into a Republican state. People respond to leadership. I've done it while others have talked about it.
CEO, we actually have a CEO of the White House. Just one, if I may, just briefly interject here. We need a zero-based budgeting. That's the way businesses are actually run. Start with
we're not a business. Baseline for God, this neoliberal logic is just insufferable. Necessary.
Oh no, he's like an ANCAP.
Absolutely.
No government programs. Limited everything. Everyone fits themselves.
It's wild to me.
I think the governor
runs a state that way. Yes. Go ahead.
You didn't ask the only guy that's been attacked. You have energy questions. You don't ask anything. But I'm just going to say right now, when you say nobody else has done it, the energy plans that have all been announced in the last month by these other folks on stage, we're already doing it in North Dakota. The border plans that I already talked about, we've got troops down at the border flying helicopter missions from North Dakota, from San Diego to the Gulf Coast, trying to stop
transportation. Why is North Dakota?
Are they at war with South Dakota?
In our state. And the energy policy, we're already doing it. It's not saying when nobody else done the big fights, North Dakota was leading the charge. We won the battle to get the Biden administration was ignoring the law. They were the first administration since Truman that wasn't holding the quarterly required lease sales. And we won that in federal court. Lotus, we won that in federal court. We're fighting the Biden administration on 20 fronts. To say that nobody's fighting the big fights, just look at the record of what we're doing right now. Energy, economy, national security have been talking about it since day one, and now finally, good, we're having the conversation about it, but we've got the answer in North Dakota.
Governor Burnham, let's talk big government. This question's for you. Big government keeps getting bigger. One-fifth of all new jobs this year have been created by...
I think Vivek is done for.
You want to shrink the size of government.
Yes.
But it's been a century.
I really think Nikki Haley turned him to the ground.
Why would you be any different?
Well, because we've done it in North Dakota. When I took office, we shrunk the state budget general fund by 27% in the first 4 months I was office. And the trains still running on time. Why? Because you had a business leader that was actually there. Inside of every government job, there's 10 or 20% of mind-numbing, soul-sucking work that even the state and federal employees don't want to do. And you can engineer that work out of the job. That would free up right there 20% of 2 million civilian employees. And by the way, we've got 10 million jobs open. They'd have plenty to do. And they could be generating taxes instead of being paid by taxes. This is totally possible to do it if you have somebody that understands that having worked in technology for 30 years, everything we had to do was to be better, faster, and cheaper the next day. That's what we can do in government. That's what we're doing in North Dakota.
Governor, I want to ask you about something that I think is on a lot of Republicans' minds. This election could come down to less than 50,000 votes in three states. Abortion was on the ballot in six states in 2022. Republicans lost all of them. Next year, abortion will likely be on the ballot. Governor DeSantis, how are you going to win over independent, pro-choice voters in Arizona?
Same way we did in Florida.
I'm not, baby.
The greatest Republican victory in a governor's race in the history of the state, over 1.5 million votes. We were winning places like Miami-Dade County, Palm Beach, that nobody thought was possible because we were leading with purpose and conviction. I reject this idea that pro-lifers are to blame for midterm defeats. I think there's other reasons for that. The former president, he's missing in action tonight. He's had a lot to say about that. He should be here explaining his comments to try to say
he did this line already,
protections
buddy.
Or something
yeah.
terrible.
Nobody else did
I want
too.
Him to look into the eyes and tell people who've been fighting this fight for a long
oh
time.
Oh my God, is Robinson is about to look at the camera and call him Donald Duck?
And I noticed that there was a quote where it says, every single person has purpose and worth. We're better off when everybody counts. And I think we should say
unless they're LGBTQ+.
Unless you're black.
Yes.
Yeah. That is well.
Extreme.
Unless you need a house.
Supporting a
yeah. Yeah. Or help.
Yeah. Or help.
You're not
or
cap.
Indigenous.
That is wrong.
Let me ask Governor Christie.
Even if your team's not in the same place, your work can be. You just need Asana. Asana organizes work, so teams know what to do, why it matters, and how to get it done. Try it for free at asana.com. That's A-S-A-N-A.
Nazis are welcome in Florida now.
That's true.
They've been, especially now. Yeah.
They're in control of the state.
Because I did it in New Jersey.
Yeah.
You know, it's...
Then why are all these other states losing?
Well, because they don't have leaders in those states who are leading the fight the way it should be led. And in fact is, look, I was the governor here of the only blue state that's represented up here. This is where the fight is really tough for Republicans. And those are the states that we're going to have to try to win if we're going to win the White House back. And what we did is 14 times, Dana, in 8 years, I vetoed Planned Parenthood funding. 14 times. No one else gets it that much. The Democrats just kept sending it to me, and I kept saying no because I believe in life, but I also believe in states' rights. And I think we fought hard against Roe versus Wade for decades to say that states should make these decisions. So we're going to have those fights in the states. What we need is a leader who can talk to people and make them understand that if you're pro-life, you have to be pro-life for the entire life, not just the 9 months in the womb. And we talked a lot about fentanyl tonight, and we haven't spoken one moment about treatment. But we need to make sure that for the drug-addicted 16-year-old on the floor of the county lockup, her life is precious, too. And we need to be providing treatment to cure this as a disease that it is. If you're pro-life,
yeah,
you're pro-life
that, I think he mixed two of your prepared statements together.
They're going to do what I did in the blue state, which was get reelected with 61% of the vote and won 70% of independents and 51% of Latinos because I told them the truth from my heart.
Thank you. Vice President Pence.
From my heart.
The latest Univision poll found that 73% of Latino voters think the Republican Party doesn't care about or is being hostile toward them, the Hispanic community. Only Governor DeSantis has translated his campaign into Spanish. How will you reach out to Latino voters?
Why? Come on, that was lame.
Well,
yeah.
That we're going to continue to build bridges to every community in this country. And I'm
listen, Governor DeSantis has been flying immigrants to Martha's Vineyard, but he put his campaign website in Spanish, so he obviously cares about the Latino community.
The lowest unemployment ever recorded for Hispanic Americans.
The
lowest unemployment ever recorded for African Americans.
It ended racism.
For women. So I think the President of the United States needs to be a champion for the American dream for every American. It begins with the unborn.
You can see why Americans don't care about politics.
With every ethnic group.
Yeah. Especially now.
And I'm especially the President of the United States.
Gibberish.
I'll be a champion for the American dream, for Hispanic Americans, and for every American. So help me God.
Okay.
Religion in place of any personality.
Example is the best way to get the job done. If you look at my office in the Senate, my chief of staff is the only Hispanic female chief of staff in the Senate. I hired her because she was the best, highest qualified person we have. What we need are leaders who lead by example. And I will simply say, I would love to finish my conversation with Nikki as it relates to the job that needs to be
done. He's really mad he was taking
that.
He's pissed.
Maybe you got to leave stuff in the past.
In South Carolina. Talk
let us forget about it.
Has never seen a federal
next to me
doesn't like 10 cents on this gallon in South Carolina as the UN ambassador. You literally
bring it
put $50,000.
That was good. Yeah.
Next.
You got bad information. First of all, I fought the gas tax in South Carolina multiple times against the
establishment. Because he did. While people were talking more
than me, too. They wouldn't pass the gas tax. The establishment, the companies wanted me to do it so much that I said the only way I will
do it is
if you will give us three.
All you have to do is go watch Nikki Haley on YouTube.
If you will give me three times the deduction and income tax, then I will look at your gas tax.
You said yes.
Secondly, on the curtains, do your homework, Tim, because Obama bought those curtains.
Did you send them back?
It's in the press.
Did you send them back?
It's the State Department.
Did
you send them back? You're the one that works in Congress.
Oh, my God.
You get
this is a personal fight.
This is very cute. So he's personal everybody.
From the same state.
Except for the man that we do not know.
Here's the fact, though.
But I cut taxes and I
Yeah, Ron wants a
they're arguing over curtains, right? I mean,
probably
the conversation Tim Scott in particular and all the people on stage want to stay away from in terms of how he tries to present himself.
Yeah.
Not a fair representation of the southern hospitality we have down here.
I feel like this has been going on for at least 5.5 hours.
We're not talking about anything.
It's all bullshit.
Zeros.
I think they'll come back for the conclusion, right? The ending statement. Should
they have to. There's no way this can go any. I mean,
no, you can't because I will have to bow out at that point.
It's not going to pass.
I'm dumb. Okay. I feel like brain is smaller, like Nikki said. But I will say, though, Nikki did bring something, stuff that we will remember. Mm-hmm. Watching this,
she said the best thing.
She's saying things, she's ringing fire. She's, you know, everybody else is cold tonight. I forgot, again, Mike Pence, where is he? Like, we haven't seen him. We know Tim Scott is only going to get 5 seconds on the clock, and everybody else is going to talk during his time. He's such... that man is so weak. It's really sad. It's really, really sad. But Nikki is holding her own. She started off a little slow, but she came in hard. She came in hot. Anybody that was trying to come against her, a lot of facts.
Right.
Anybody, and she's ready too. Anybody who tried to come against her, she made sure like it was. She wasn't giving anything that was like, okay, let me give a Twitter, Twitter fact or a Twitter line or whatever. Like he's saying, go find out this information from YouTube about Nikki Haley. There's a lot of misinformation out there. She came ready. She just, and then she told him like, bring it. And then with Vivek, like he thought he was doing something there. She was like, sit down, child. Let a child stay in a child's place. Because I'm growing. I've been here. I've done this. You just coming in here. You have no experience. So hush. Like, she's been going down the line. Yeah, she's been, go ahead, and she's been putting out. She's been.
Folks,
definitely.
But I wonder if that's just us. You heard it here first. Rebecca coming out strong with her endorsement of Nikki Haley.
Not at all. If I had to choose in this moment right now, like who won the night, even though this night is a mess, I could have done without it. Yeah. It
even though
be,
this shit
Nikki
doesn't matter
prepare.
At all.
No, they're not going to be Trump. Yeah.
We're all fighting really hard for second place.
Exactly. Even if he was here for the night, he wouldn't even be answering questions. But they all live on his penis. That doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
I would like to see Nikki Haley on the stage with Trump. Actually, that.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
That would be something. That's the only person that I can see right now who would be able to...
We'll see, but that's my question. Is that just us, or do you think that played well amongst Republicans? Because I just looked online, and a lot of people are mad at Nikki Haley, but those people happen to be Vivek fans. Like Tim Pool, for example, he's straight up being like, is Nikki Haley the most annoying person in the world?
They don't like
saying the same thing.
It's that, and Nikki Haley is more of the neocon variety of Republican.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
The online Republican right do not like neocons, which obviously leftists don't like neocons either, but we like them for a different – we don't like them for a very different reason than why the Nazi right online factions don't like the neocons.
I mean, didn't she say today that women should have – even though she slightly said it at the last debate, like women should – have say so about their bodies. I mean, who's voting for somebody like that? Girl, I mean, I like how she's talking. It's nice. It's cute. We know she ain't gonna win. But it's nice to see somebody who's able to actually answer questions, have something to say.
Answer bites.
I put in some kind of work. Yeah, something.
What's
the curtain all about? Do any of you know? Do you know that reference? What is the curtain?
Obama sent her some lovely curtains that she used, apparently.
And she put them up, and they were mad, and she said, well, Tim, you was working in Congress. Why you ain't take them down? It was
I love that.
Like,
the thing about like Chris Christie giving Obama a hug, like there's
a huge deal.
They focus on these like, oh, you accepted this kind gesture by Obama. How dare you?
They brought that up at the last debate to Chris Christie. You hugged Obama. That was after Christie accused him of plagiarizing Obama.
And they, their voters work on this bullshit. That's why they bring this crap up.
Mm-hmm. Please let the last take, but I can't take it.
No.
I know. We have a few minutes.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah,
thank
please,
God.
It's that if you all stay in the race, former President Donald Trump wins the nomination. None of you have indicated that you're dropping out. So, which one of you on stage tonight should be voted off the island?
What? Are they really willing to survive?
Draw your choice on the notepad in front of you. 15 seconds, starting now. Of the people on the stage, who should be voted? I'm absolutely serious.
Are you serious?
I mean, we're here, like, you know, we're happy to debate Trump. I think that that's disrespectful to my fellow competitors.
Nobody wants to
I think that's.
They're going to take it.
I don't think they agree with that, too. They don't.
I'm impressed. Right. I'm actually impressed.
Yeah, they don't agree with
that. Let me ask you something. Yeah. Then if you will answer that question, let me ask you this one.
Yeah.
What is your mathematical path,
yes,
Governor DeSantis, in order to try to beat President Trump, who has a commanding and enduring lead in this race?
So, polls don't elect presidents. Voters elect presidents.
Right.
And we're going to take the case of the people in these early states. We're going to move the state-by-state direction. Mm-hmm. And why? Because as Reagan said in his day, this is our time for choosing. We are not getting a mulligan on the 2024 election. Republicans have lost 3 straight elections in a row. We were supposed to have a red wave with inflation at 9%. It crashed and burned. Not in Florida, it didn't. We delivered it in Florida. And so we've got to choose right. We've got to win. And we need somebody that's going to be able to serve 2 terms. So in January of 2023, they'll be able to address the nation saying, we turned the economy around, we secured the border, and we fended off the threat from communist China. As your president, I will get that job done.
Governor Christie, I believe I did see you write something. Governor Christie, I believe, excuse me. Governor Christie, I believe I did see you write something on the card.
No, but I'll certainly tell you.
That's not your business.
Look, I think everyone on this stage has been clear about this. I voted Donald Trump off the island right now. And the reason I voted him off the island, every person on this stage has shown the respect.
I did see you write something. Governor Christie, I believe, excuse me. Governor Christie, I believe I did see you write something on the card.
No, but I'll certainly tell you.
That's not your business.
Look, I think everyone on this stage has been clear about this. I voted Donald Trump off the island right now. And the reason I voted him off the island... Every person on this stage has shown the respect for Republican voters to come here to express their views honestly, candidly, and directly, and to take your questions honestly. I have respect for every man and woman on this stage because they've done it. Vivek, put your hand down for a second, would you?
Learn his name.
This guy has not only divided our party, he's divided families all over this country. He's divided friends all over this country. I've spoken to people, and I know everyone else has, who have sat at Thanksgiving dinner or at a birthday party and can't have a conversation anymore if they disagree with Donald Trump. He needs to be voted off the island, and he needs to be taken out of this process.
I have a different view on this. I think Trump was an excellent president. But the America First agenda does not belong to one man. It does not belong to Donald Trump. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to you, the people of this country. And the question is, who's going to unite this country and take the America First agenda to the next level? When we rallied behind the cry to make America great again, we did not just hunger for a single man. We hungered for the unapologetic pursuit of excellence. So yes, I will respect Donald Trump and his legacy because it's the right thing to do.
Oh my God!
Kiss ass. Shut the country.
To take the he is hungering for that man. To the next level. Very hungry and thirsty.
They end on him. Depressing.
Yeah. Is Mike Pence there?
Oh.
What about the monster guy?
I want to hear more about Mike Pence's sexual exploits. Didn't think we'd learn that.
I know. I would.
Yeah. Wow. What?
He did not mean to say that.
He definitely didn't think.
I bet he took your everybody.
Yeah. I smash.
Can you put the camera on her really quick? Nancy? Yeah, I tap that. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like gay. Like, hey, let me know. I'll be bringing it down. I'm like, this is so, it is just, this is out of control. It was really boring, but really exciting.
Yeah.
Like high moments and then like low moments. It was really a lot of low moments. It was a joke. It was another circus. And we're not getting anything that makes us feel like, you know,
it's like
what?
A really bad circus. It's like if you go to a circus and then the trapeze artists fall on the floor and you're just like, oh damn, that sucks.
Yeah.
It's really depressing. It's a really depressing circus.
It's like, oh no, he deserved that. You don't know. I guess that's what you feel like. No, he deserved. Vivek fell. His whole face is. He deserved that. Shut up.
Well,
like, send him out of here.
Seeing him face plant was really sweet. I think that honestly, if I had to pick a winner, not that it matters. I think that, like you all said, Nikki Haley was probably the best, just because she actually put herself out there and attacked other people. Like, as you were saying earlier, Rebecca, like, it felt like they were just trying to get from soundbite to soundbite, like, in their heads envisioning what their campaign is going to tweet about. Like, the, hey, Donald Duck, like, okay, but where's the real substance? Like, there's no actual back and forth in conversation. But Nikki Haley, to her credit, was the only one that actually fostered that. So I think that just by that alone, she looks the most serious, even though none of them look serious, arguably.
Yeah.
I just want to show you what we missed. Here's a speech that Trump gave.
But we will stop him. Hopefully, your leaders at United Auto Workers will endorse Donald Trump.
That's, of course, his focus of the entire speech is that he should get the endorsement, as opposed to fighting the auto workers. Not even there. He's not even speaking to the UAW. He's speaking to a private. He was invited by the executives of a private company. That are not unionized.
Non-union workers, yeah.
Can you play it one more time, David, before you close it?
One more time. Okay. But we will stop him. Hopefully your leaders at United Auto Workers will endorse Donald Trump.
This is not going to get hard.
Oh, he's back. That's a good round clock.
Now, this is
one
people
and zero
will...
and two.
I got that soundboard. It's my favorite soundboard.
It's not only us that take them as a joke, right? And I'm not talking about Trump. I'm talking about the panel, people who are
the second place auditioners.
Yeah, the D-listers. All of them are. But it's not only us. Even the moderators took them as a joke. You can't tell me that's how you're ending it. You, first of all, you call that man's numbers, the little numbers, the mere 19%. Then when at the end of it, you said who's going to be voted off the island because the moderators none of you guys are going to survive this. The polls are saying that nobody wants any of you guys. You guys suck. You guys are not even on the level that Donald Trump is with this, so why even try? So let's play a game, and one of you guys, like, kill each other off the island. Who would it be? And I did like to see that everybody was like, now, hold on, lady. You don't come over here disrespecting us now. We're the ones that are here. Even though they're not doing anything, they're not saying anything,
I have to interject and say, there was like two people who said that. The rest of them actually had their pens up and were ready to do it. Is it possible to rewind to that moment so we could watch who picked up the pad and was ready to do it? Because I'm telling you, I saw more than a few people lift up the paper, ready to go.
Yeah,
and like Santos, I think, was the first who was like,
first
I'm not
he wrote
doing
something
this.
On his paper. That's what
he did,
That man was nosy, the British man. He's like, well, what you got on your paper?
Donald Trump, obviously.
It's a joke, but like everybody, people were
Donald Duck.
But then it was like, you know what? We are here together. But Christy, you wrote something on your paper. Now you acting up. Let's be seen. You write something on your paper.
Share it with the rest of the class.
How amazing would it be though if they actually did do it and they voted someone and then like, but. Before the debate started, the audience decided to vote to give somebody a secret hidden immunity idol.
Right now, we're going to have callers call in. The line is now open. You too can vote. 555-3. 555-3. three, you can vote for.
I would smash my phone.
Yes.
As soon as that moment's up and available, you gotta watch it. Because you know that viral clip that's been going around Twitter that everyone's making fun of that woman sitting waiting for her IHOP food, and she's like all like over the top, happy to like dive into it. Oh, I swear they said the question, and you saw all those candidates were like, "All right, I'm gonna write it on somebody's name."
I think that's going to be a talked about moment, the end of the debates when the woman asked the question, and I think that will be more of a talked about moment as well. I think that the Republicans, when they do their think pieces, they're starting right now, but I think as the articles come out tomorrow and the think pieces come out tomorrow, I really think that they should focus on the fact that none of them were answering questions. But here's where people aren't even serious in that department. They're just going to focus on the fact that like maybe Vivek was quieted too much or this and that. They ain't gonna talk about Tim Scott at all, child. But you know they're gonna play on the stuff that makes no sense, and they're not gonna focus on the fact that these leaders were not saying anything that is going to affect the people in any way, shape, or form. That's going to help the people in any way, shape, or form. They're not going to focus on that. And I think that's where we missed them, or what that's where they missed the mark. And Democrats missed the mark there as well, too. I bet you during their debates, we're going to see a lot of Twitter points, we're going to see a lot of that. You think this was something? I think when it gets to the other side, we're going to see a lot of that, too. So
I do think you pointed it out great about how, Tim Scott's gonna get ignored. I mean, one of the moments during the debate, was like, and now let's go to Tim Scott for an answer. And Tim Scott's like, well, as a black, ding, 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 yeah. Okay, your time is up.
Thank you so much. Listen, we already don't want you up here. And here you go talking about being black. And you keep referring to African-American stats. Stop. But, he needs to just hang it up. And he's holding on to grudges from the past debate, and he's holding on to grudges from 5 minutes ago, and they need to let it go. He was like, listen, yeah,
frenemies.
Yeah. She's like, I love you, Tim. Mean it. But you don't do nothing. You don't do a thing.
Bring it, Tim.
I just gotta share this tweet from Jake Paul, who supports Vivek. Vivek is right. You know, the president wants to beat Trump or Biden. They need the youth. It might be a shock to y'all that most 18 to 20-year-olds don't use this platform, let alone care about politics. He wants to raise the voting age. Vivek wants to raise the voting age.
Right.
Most of these people can't vote. Like, this is so...
We need our youth to vote!
We need our youth to vote. But if Vivek gets in power, then they will not, because he will make it illegal. It is just so goddamn...
Well, he wants to, but it is unconstitutional, as is the case with him trying to ban birthright citizenship, which he benefited from, which is absolutely still wild.
Yeah.
And the fact that they want the Supreme Court to revisit or to visit this as if there's even a question that would be acceptable. I mean, you can interpret a lot of provisions within the Constitution, but that one is really fucking clear, even if you very much tried to nitpick. And it's just, like, I think that the best point, maybe it was Rebecca that said it, is that, like, he is doing this because he's trying to prove to them, kind of assuage fears, that he would be as racist as them. In fact, he'd be more racist, so you don't have to fear the fact that he's the non-white candidate. It's okay. He'll be super racist, super fascistic.
It was trash. It was just garbage. I mean, like, I'm trying to find the good parts in it, because we watched it in full, and I don't want to feel like...
Sunken cost fallacy.
There's no good parts. The whole thing fucking sucks. It doesn't matter anyways. They're all fighting for second place. None of this really matters.
Shit, this is what we would like. This.
We watch this looking
for trying to find the personals
and potential entertainment that may come out of it, and maybe there were some potential entertainment moments, but it was just.
Yeah.
Even if like Nikki Haley in our minds maybe came out the winner
still,
of that debate, none of it fucking matters. None of it matters, right? It doesn't matter.
The bar is, it's low, okay?
Yeah.
That's
right.
Where we, as long as we understand that. But it's just, I just find it to be like, politics has gone to a place where, I mean, it's always been a place where it's like, it's never been fair, I would say. And it's always been a spot for the white men. But Now that even with a little bit of diversity, they going to disrespect people right on camera. They going to disrespect you right in your face, no matter what, no matter if you are in the Congress, no matter what seats you got, no matter where you've been, you'll be disrespected. But it's just a joke. Like, nobody is saying anything. They're not even faking it. They're just not going to answer your question. And they're still going to expect you to vote for them.
Oh, speaking of faking it, why is Vivek still doing the whole, like, I came from humble beginnings, my parents had to work hard, blah, blah, blah. He, like, got the George for that, I bet he saw. He looked at his tax return, and he's like, the year he was getting $1,000 from the George Soros Foundation, you were clocking in $450,000 a year. You are not, like, some, you know, humble beginnings, like, story. Like, how many of us are $450,000 a year at that part of your life?
Humble beginning story sells. You know, I mean, we see that story sells so much so that Ron DeSantis keeps making them up on the fly. I keep laughing at the penny in the pan.
People go on.
That's a story that we were all confused then. And then whatever story, he gave like three stories. And that's how he wants to tell himself with these stories. Like when I came off of that plane and I felt the breeze against my skin. And then he talked about how, wow, I mean, being more of a conservative coming from an Ivy League school, that's, sir, most people that come from Ivy League schools are very conservative. What are you talking about? Like, these stories are not, who are you trying to relate to? Because it's not relatable. Like, the stats that they were giving about Florida, you still weren't, you were trying to back them up, and it was clear that you're going to stick right behind your being racist. You're going to stick right behind being a capitalist. You don't care about your people. You care about certain people. And let's make that clear.
Right.
You don't care about educators. You don't care about education. Like, you don't care about healthcare. That was clear. But people will still sit here and they're going to say, well, Ron DeSantis, even if they know that everything that man is saying will not benefit them, just because they are in Florida and they represent red, Republican, conservative, the right, they will just say, I have to stick by Ron DeSantis.
The worst part. I mean, think about what the opposition is going to spend on advertising against this, right? Like $25, $30 million in advertising from the Biden administration to have some sort of a response to what? Like, these guys aren't even really auditioning for, like, cable news pundit at this point. Nobody would have them. Like these debates are basically just generating fodder for, you know, mainstream media tomorrow morning, right? But, like, what is there to use, even? Like, I just feel like they could easily cancel the rest of it. How many more of these debates are there? They could just cancel them.
There's only one more. November 8th, baby, we'll be back.
Yeah, I think people are probably more excited for November
30th.
That's
kind of surprising.
What is it, Newsom and DeSantis going head-to-head? I think people would probably...
Is that happening?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, November 30th, I think.
Mm-hmm.
On hand.
That's a private thing though, right? It's not part of the actual official.
No, it's not part of this at all. No, but I mean, I think that's my point. Is like that would be more interesting than anything.
Oh, the head.
Look at that.
What is happening?
Wow. Broken bobblehead.
Ew.
Man.
You tell me he's a robot. You know what? Maybe he is.
What is going on?
Something's going on there with that guy.
Yeah, something happened to him. He's off. And
listen, there's something wrong. Like, he just doesn't feel like he has to.
I'll tell you, he's a sociopath. He doesn't know how to.
That's what it is.
Exactly.
That's what it is.
But listen, I saw four, and I went up to them and I asked, "Hey, what's your biggest problem?" They said, "Biden being a communist."
Yeah.
People can't buy groceries in your city. What does that mean to you, Ron?
Oh, yeah, he was talking about grocery shop. We all know he doesn't do that. He also said he talked to three people who all got mugged that day. Like, what? The mass muggings were happening all over the streets.
That's like Patty who dodged, but just survived three abortions.
Three abortions,
like,
right?
She's like, whoa, another one. Whoa, fuck.
Drinking in a pan. I don't even know. I still don't understand that story and why there was a pan involved.
I feel like if in any other situation, if someone says that, you would think they're completely nuts. You would get them some help. But it's like at a Republican debate, and it's just like not even talked about again. Don't mention it. Like, it's not. That should be a big news story. What the hell is Ron DeSantis talking about? Is he okay? Like,
she was in their pan, child, and she survived. Did she live in that pan? I don't know.
I have so many questions.
They cracked her like an egg out of the uterus, and then they had to raise her in the pan.
She survived in her umbilical cord.
I hated that story so much.
They put her in a sandwich bag, and they kept like feeding food to the umbilical cord.
I'm sorry.
It's so weird. Oh, but honestly, I can't get over it. So, Rebecca, once you said that Doug Burgum looks like he's wearing a mask, I couldn't unsee it.
It's like he needed, like, he could just go like this and take it off.
Yeah,
how much we
still
don't know who he is. Like,
yeah.
you still don't know him.
It looks like Sacha Baron Cohen, right? Like, playing a character.
What if his character?
I mean, what if? What if?
Like,
He looks like the character from I Think You Should Leave. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I'll get you the photo.
Hold on.
Yeah, like the prank gone wrong.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
That weird monster thing.
Yeah,
the weird looking old guy.
Barely qualified for this, right? Like, he had to, like, interject and yell out.
He was only asked two questions,
I think.
What were the standards to make the debate?
But he was butting in.
Not sure.
Yeah, I see that. You see, it does look like a, like, you can tell this guy has a mask on. That's how that guy looks. But you're right. He was only asked like two questions, but he made sure.
Someone pull up Burgum. Next time.
Yeah, so you had to have like 3%. Polling or something like that. You had to meet like a donor threshold, and you had to sign the RNC pledge.
He paid for his spot for sure.
Yeah.
Bloomberg
style.
And he made sure in this debate that he would butt into everybody's stuff. He was the one on the side. We were hearing a faint voice. He was one of those ones that were making comments while other people were talking, and his mic was off. He made sure that he was going to be heard this evening.
Yeah. He won't be there at the next one. Who do you think's going to be there at the next one? Most of these guys? It's just so comical.
Yeah.
I love Binder's.
Probably all of them except for, well, definitely not Burgum, but
no.
who else would not be at the next one? Yeah. If they'd elect five people for the next one.
Mm.
I think Vince took a hit.
Who that looks like Beavis and Butt? Because that was good. Because it was killing me. Because I'm like, yes, Jimmy Neutron, that's easy. We know that. But
yeah,
but Beavis and Butt, that's, mm-hmm. yeah. I can see that for
yeah,
sure.
All forehead.
Yeah, it's all forehead. And then he has Vegeta's hairline from Dragon Ball. Widow's Peak, I got him. He's his. He really, the way that they're treating him now, I thought he was going to come in strong. They're treating him like, you still got milk on your tongue, little boy. Like, you have nothing to offer us, so shut up.
Yeah.
Like, and he's really being quiet these days, so he needs to just bow out, too. It ain't working for him.
Yeah, I feel like this isn't going to help him. I don't think this is going to help any of them. I hope that the goading of Trump to show up will have any effect, but I really don't think it will. He has no reason at all to show up to these. It would be fun. Like, I would be interested again if Trump did show up to these, just because I think that the fireworks would be there and would be very entertaining. But, I mean, there's no value. There's literally no value.
What if
he
waited
until
the third one? Wow.
It's helped him by avoiding them.
I think
okay, so,
too.
I found the most recent update on all the stats on them. So Trump's at 54%, DeSantis 13.8%, Haley at 6.3%, tied with Vivek at 6.3%, Pence 4.6%, mm-hmm. Christie 2.9%, Scott 2.7%. And then after that,
wow.
That's according to who?
538, their live estimate.
It's amazing DeSantis is still in second place to me. Like, I'm actually surprised by that.
Yeah.
Lower.
I'm not, because everybody was going for him, and I think that it's going to dwindle down more, but I'm interested to see when those update, and I want to see where Nikki will be. Now, her and who are tied, you said?
I can see Tim Scott not making the next one. He's the lowest on this list. They let him know he was the lowest.
They were like, get out of here.
But you know what? Trump wouldn't show up for the last debate. It would be funny if he did, if he waited like, you know, until he had more confidence and saw how everyone did in two debates. But he would have to sign the RNC pledge to support whoever the nominee was.
He's not showing up to any debates. He has no reason to. Like, there's no reason to show up to any debate. Yeah. Like, unless it comes down to him and someone else, and the other person starts gaining, then at that point, maybe.
He hasn't been to them yet, and look where he's fallen. And I think that him rebelling the way that he does, and every time the debates are on, he makes sure that he is appearing at the same time doing something. And so that is working in his favor. And they're just like, wow, what? Like, he's just a true revolutionary. He likes to rebel. He goes against the grain. This is a president, man. This is a president. And everybody who says that should definitely just go ahead. Put that red lipstick out all around your lip. Put the little clown hat on because you're a clown. You're a clown. You're a joke.
It's amazing that he isn't being.
Are gonna have you wondering what in the world. Yo, thank God for TikTok. That was in the Spanish news. I don't think we would have ever heard about this case in the U.S. if it wasn't for TikTok. A famous Spanish model. I don't know how true this story is, but a famous Spanish model ran out of the building. They're trying to initiate her into some Illuminati-ish. It's crazy.
What if I told you that the year might actually be 1724? In the 1990s, several German historians proposed a radical idea that the Middle Ages, in fact, didn't exist, and we are actually living in the 18th century. In 1582, the Pope introduced the Gregorian calendar. Prior to this, most of the world was using the Julian calendar. The Julian calendar had a leap year every 4 years, in which an extra day was added. Since the solar year is technically a little over 365 days, the Julian calendar gains a day every 128 years. To account for this, when the Gregorian calendar was introduced, they should have shifted the date by 13 days. So here we have two possibilities. If Pope had done the math wrong, 300 years in between then and now don't actually exist, and large chunks of history have been fabricated. But the phantom time hypothesis points out that it's way more than just a Pope making a simple mistake. It points out the lack of records of big events.
This is not the first time that I've heard almost this exact same theory that states that we are not really supposed to be in the year 2023, but the 1700s? That's crazy.
Everyone knows about Epstein Island, but have you heard about Rothschild's Island?
I don't even know who that is.
The Rothschilds are like the most mainstream name when it comes to the Illuminati. Oh, everybody knows about it.
Right.
But yeah, they bought an island off the coast of Antarctica. Why would you want an island in Antarctica?
Right.
Why would anyone go to Antarctica?
I think there could be like secret tunnels that have built in under there.
Your go-to is always secret tunnels.
There's no other reason for them to have an island.
Penguins?
Wait, why do we need cell towers every 3 miles if the president can call the moon in 1969? That's because that didn't happen that way. There's no possible way. We don't have a cell tower on the moon. Think about it.
Well, did a TV channel just accidentally play out Prince Philip's obituary before he had died? Well, according to social media reports, yes. So an eagle-eyed Twitter user managed to capture the moment on camera that the BBC allegedly switches over from a live broadcast of an MP to random 1930s clips of the Duke of Edinburgh. In the live broadcast, the MP is cut off live to switch over to black and white clips of Prince Philip. The black and white video plays out twice before becoming glitchy, and then the screen turns to black. At the end of the video, the BBC puts out an apology. Other social media users also claim they saw the same thing, with this man tweeting out, "Did someone press the emergency Prince Philip obituary button during the Salmond inquiry?" To which he was met with comments agreeing. Well, there's no evidence to suggest that the clip came from an obituary piece. What I can tell you from someone who works in media is that these things are prepared in advance.
Right.
They make a hole in, and they put, they tie a string around, yeah, and then they put it all around the body, but they're naked. And they got this tattoo on the private with, like, little piercings.
Okay.
Not, like, earrings, but, like, little gold piercings around the private.
Yeah.
And they all dance around with skulls on in the church there.
What kind of church?
Okay.
So they have skulls, like, the teachers and the staff, they got 20 skulls each.
The way she's telling the story, it doesn't sound like it's something that this child is making up. It sounds like a matter of fact, right? Oh my God, protect the babies.
Got 20 each.
Yes, because I counted once. So there's one here, and then there's one here, and there's one on that here. Look, it looks like skulls everywhere, on the knees, on the elbows. It looks like armor.
Satanic ritual. You see it down here at the bottom. What does it sound like?
Okay, so if I was to try and find these skulls, where would,
yes,
I find them?
Yes, yes, in church.
Where in church? Church?
So there's this secret rooms. They've got secret rooms.
Go on, tell me, how do I find the secret?
So when you go in the secret rooms, because they hide it in loads of places. So
would you be able to help me find them, would you?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so they just hide them anywhere. They just hide it, like, in one place, then they move to other place, then they move to other place. It's just...
Okay, so...
Where is this girl at today? What year is this being... This was 2014? This should be a follow-up interview with this girl now. She might be, I don't know, either in her late teens or maybe a young adult now. I would love to hear her tell this story again. It would probably be more detailed.
I go into the church now.
Yes, and they hide, usually they hide it in their houses. Because they have parties in their houses.
Okay.
Because Mr. Collins, my teacher,
yes,
he lives in Highgate.
Right.
Yes. You can see his house because his Porsche.
Yeah.
He got a Porsche and it's just at the front of his house.
Okay. So, how do you know he keeps them in his house?
Because I know because of...
Do not search for the terms discussed in this video on Yandex or elsewhere, as you could be committing a crime. The findings have been reported to authorities, and the research is supervised by legal counsel. No illegal imagery is shown. Do not contact or harass anyone mentioned.
What is this? Y'all, by the way, this is the first time I'm seeing any of this stuff, so y'all are about to be just as shocked as I am.
Stay far away from, and then it shows my location. assume for a second that this person's not a troll, and they really do know something I don't. Well then, what is it exactly that I'm getting into here? What is it that I'm in danger of?
On looking into it, it appeared that this girl was one of many.
A former Scotland Yard detective, John Wedger, was part of a small team investigating allegations in London.
We had dozens of young kids aging from 9 to 14 years old.
But when Officer Wedger, quote, dug too deep, he was given a similar warning.
I was brought before someone who is now a very, very high-ranked officer in the UK indeed, and he said, you will be thrown to the wolves. You have no idea who and what you are dealing with. He said, I'm warning you now, you must back away.
Although it can be disconcerting, and at times I do wonder if what I'm doing here is even worth it. As of now, I have no intention of stopping.
What?
Now, the new information you're about to see ostensibly involves Tom Hanks.
First of all, it looks like an ad for Chevy.
Whether or not Hanks is aware of any of this remains to be seen. Nonetheless, some of the images he's posted to his social media are not only relevant to the findings, it's how they were discovered. The person who provided this tip wishes to remain anonymous under the alias Veritas Fautior.
Not Tom Hanks.
But why Tom Hanks? An actor I've loved since I was a kid.
Right.
A man whose films are consistently inspirational, influential, and iconic. Yeah. This is true. But it's also true that recently, a new range of theories have begun to emerge, showing a different side to the Hollywood actor. Many of the claims are unfounded and nonsensical. Okay. I'm not saying they're all... As I did with part one, no theories will be given, just information and context. So one reason some have recently changed their perspective of Hanks surrounds the testimony of a former Hollywood actor, Isaac Cappy.
Oh, I'm not going to talk about Tom Hanks either, who is also... Well, Tom Hanks, folks, is a... I'm sorry if this is the kind of bursting your bubble, all this information is new.
Isaac claimed that within Hollywood, a high society is involved in child trafficking.
Yeah, Tom Hanks. Tom Hanks, guys.
It's so crazy when we hear these, you know, these allegations come out. I've heard this man say this mess before, right? I'm not trying to discredit him or anything, but you wonder if it's such a high number of child trafficking happening within the United States. Whatever happens to these kids? Do they become sacrifices? Do they eventually get released back into society, but told not to tell their stories? What happens to them? Because it doesn't seem like, you know...
Hello. Come on. Don't you know that I need a little red Robin?
Yum. This stuff has been going on for decades and decades, heck, even a century, that we would hear more from the victims if they are still around.
Called out, no response.
Information he claimed was privy to because of his time spent among Hollywood's gentility.
I'm in their source code. These people are being taken aboard to San Francisco, some sort of R&D project for a new Terminator.
And this, make no mistake, this is a cult. There is a widespread cult that is worldwide. And by the way, the proof is in the pudding. If I'm lying, sue me. Sue me. Great, let's go to court. Let's have discovery.
As Cappy's following grew, he took measures to ensure his safety. One of which he alleged included a quote, dead man's switch.
What does that do? It means they can't kill me, which is good because I like to stay alive. A dead man's switch is basically it's like if you die, then like stuff happens, okay? Like information goes out. They can try to kill me. You know, good luck with that.
Many expected Cappy to continue expanding upon his testimony. Instead, he uploaded one of his final videos.
My anger at these people, my anger consumed me. Did I
about Seth Green now? Seth Green. Am I afraid of something? Well, I should be, because bad things are coming my way.
3 days later, Cappy was found dead in what local authorities assert was a suicide.
That's what they do, right? When these people come out and speak on this stuff, what ends up happening to them? Miraculously, they have pulled the plug on themselves. Why is it that they always pull the plug on themselves? It's always said that, hey, that's the cover-up. They said some crazy stuff, so it makes sense that they're crazy and that they pull the plug on themselves, right? That's the term that I'm going with. But then you have the people that come out and say this type of stuff. They also follow with, hey, if it comes out that I have pulled the plug on myself, don't believe it. It's a lie. I'm not crazy. I wasn't expecting for this clip to be in here. No, sir.
It's worth noting that Calvin was asked here if he currently felt suicidal.
I'm not suicidal. I'm not suicidal.
Purportedly, Cappy jumped from that bridge and was hit by a truck.
Or somebody threw him.
Soon after, a controversial video began making its rounds on the internet.
Sure what I'm seeing, but I know I don't like it. And I'm not zooming in for y'all either. This looks bad. Whatever it is.
You promised you wouldn't hurt my mom and dad if I came back, right?
Sarah Ruth Ashcraft accused Tom Hanks of purchasing her from her father. She claims to have most of her childhood.
I depersonalize a lot of this because it's really ugly, tough stuff. I'm glad something's being done about it
now. Now, her story could be real. But it also could be clout. We do not know. I'm not going to assume that it's real, and I'm not going to assume that it's fake. I'm just listening, like we all are.
Because nobody should have to look back on their childhood memories and realize that the things that they thought were just meaningless and innocent were anything but that.
Now that's fascinating. That is fascinating. And I've heard a lot of people tell stories like that where, you know, when they're manipulated into thinking that this is normal, this is acceptable, only to find out as adults that those things that happened to them as children were not acceptable, were not normal. And now when they think back on the stuff that happened to them, now here's this trauma. This trauma that just rushes into their spirit out of almost nowhere. And it's like when they recount what occurred to them or what happened to them, then they just start to think about, okay, this was a lot worse than I realized it was during that time. I knew there was something off about it. I knew I didn't feel right. I knew it didn't feel right, but I didn't know it was as bad as it was. A lot of us, and I do mean a lot of us, me included, have been there.
Nobody should have to discover these things about their own life.
I noticed you have this obsession on Instagram
with lost gloves.
Well, it's lost objects, but it started with lost gloves. And I, first of all, there's a story behind them all. What happened? What happened to its mate? How did this Lindfeld glove get lost? Is someone going to keep the other glove at home on the off chance that they're going to pair it up?
Okay, now that, I'm not going to lie, that's Holly weird. That is Holly weird. You, an average person like you and I will see a freaking a glove on the ground, and we're thinking, what do we think? Oh, somebody lost one of their gloves, you know. It, we're not thinking that there's this whole other story as to what's going on with the other glove, as if the other glove is being kept somewhere. We're just thinking, well, they lost one glove. They're like, heck, I only got one glove now. Might as well throw this one away. So they toss it in the trash. We're not thinking about the stories behind these missing items, and this is weird.
It's a little bit of, you know, Romeo and Juliet kind of quality.
No, it ain't.
There's a, you see, there's a little bit of a hint of sadness.
It's just weird.
It's like it's telling you a tale, but you don't know what the tale
They're
is.
All bittersweet city adventures.
Let's take a look at some of these. I want to put this up. This is one you took, and, Tell me, what's going on here? Why is this so evocative to you?
Well, first of all, I don't touch them. I just see them, and I photograph them, so I have...
You know what, you're DM.
Oh, yeah, I it makes sense that he's not touching them. Better not touch them. Better not touch
them.
Well, you know, it could be a crime scene. Let's not give the cops a break.
That's strange. I ain't gonna hold you. That's different.
Notice
I ain't never even knew this.
But in this image, we see another glove. But this time, we also see letters.
Yep. It looked like SRCUSA.
Look closely and spell them out for yourself. What does the top row spell? SRC.
I was right.
And what does the bottom row spell? USA.
Right again. I didn't want to try to pronounce it all out, put it all together, because I wasn't 100% sure if I read those letters correctly.
Here's what happens when you run a search for SRCUSA on DuckDuckGo. It shows nothing out of the ordinary. The same goes for the Images tab. And the same also goes for Google.
Okay.
In the trailer update video I uploaded prior, I provided tips for independent researchers to use. Among those was to utilize multiple search engines.
When I tell you the things that were being shown in that video got so disturbing, was making me so uncomfortable, that I had to just skip past it. I couldn't take no more. But we're going to continue the rest of this video. Hopefully it doesn't get that bad again. That was crazy.
The Vatican is likely the most corrupt institution in our world. The Vatican is no stranger to murder, child trafficking, drug trafficking, sex exploitation, and cover-ups.
What?
Arguably one of the most famous basilicas in the world, underneath it lies a mass graveyard. So located about 5 stories beneath the basilica is actually another temple dating back to the Roman Empire. That's over 2,000 years of dead bodies. If you're wondering if those bodies are of Christians or Catholics, they're not. It was actually used for pagans. And here are some of the mosaic tiles that they found beneath the Vatican in the temple that it's built on top of. Oh, here's a quote from one of the popes. I believe that the church not only should apologize to the person who is gay, whom it has offended, but it has to apologize to the poor, to the exploited women, to children exploited for labor. It has to ask forgiveness for having blessed many weapons. That's a little ironic considering what the Vatican has done to make sure that it's always protected and people never expose them. This is Pope John Paul I, and he died 33 days after his election. Now, the conspiracy around his death is that he found out the Vatican was laundering mass amounts of money, and he was going to rectify the situation of getting rid of everybody in the Vatican that was corrupt. His plans were announced straight after he became the Pope, and he died 33 days later. In 2015, it was uncovered that two cases of child were found within the Vatican walls. And get this, not everybody involved was named. Only a couple names took the blow for everybody else in the Vatican. And then the year before that, the government actually intercepted three deliveries directed to the Vatican, all containing drugs. Cocaine was found in condoms inside of these three deliveries that were intercepted. They were handed over to the Vatican in hopes that somebody within the walls would disclose who this was going to, but nobody came forward. This is St. Peter's Obelisk, and not a lot of people know where it comes from. One of Rome's cruelest emperors, Caligula, actually stole this from one of Egypt's cities, Heliopolis. Stole it from Egypt and he transported it to Rome. And you know what he did with it? It was used to murder and execute Christians. They would round up every single Christian that they could find, chain them, bound them, bring them to the obelisk, and brutally murder them.
What? Oh, she's muted. She's saying some stuff, y'all.
Books is called The Grand Grimoire or The Red. And this book is about black magic. It harnessed spells and rituals, but many believe...
Y'all ever, like, listened to something or saw something that was, like, so disturbing that you felt like you were, like, gasping for air, like somebody had their hand around your throat, like you couldn't breathe? That's how I was feeling, like, about 40 seconds ago. I felt like I was about to pass out or something. I don't know. It was like a spell was over me or something. It was, I don't know, just evil.
This is the book that they use to summon the devil when they are selling their souls. Kind of like the book of the Illuminati. The conspiracies of the Vatican can go on and on and on. It's truly a never-ending cycle. One thing we do know, the people in the Vatican are evil and corrupt. Let me know what you guys think about this in the comments below, and I'll see you in the next video.
Man, this stuff is getting weird, man. It's getting creepy. But anyway, leave your thoughts, comments, and opinions down below. I'm going to catch y'all in the next one. Y'all stay blessed. See ya.
all the ingredients that go into your favorite recipe.
All right, Ben Davidson of Suspicious Observers, welcome. It's such a pleasure to finally do this with you. Let's give it like 5-10 more seconds to make sure that I'm live on both ends. Can you do a refresh for me to double check that? Stand by. We're going to make sure that this is all good to go.
Standing by.
Are you doing a refresh on the computer? Everybody that's listening? All right, so we're good on YouTube. Waiting on Rumble. Let's see here. Should be good. Rumble's good. All right, everybody, we're live. This is Ben Davidson of Suspicious Observers. My name is Jimmy Corsetti of Bright Inside Channel, as some of you know. But Ben Davidson is a gentleman that was an attorney in a former life, and he went down the rabbit hole and has been sharing amazing information involving cycles of the sun, catastrophes on Earth. He's led me down this rabbit hole to see that the big missing link involving catastrophes on Earth is involving sun cycles. And he's also the gentleman that introduced me to the Adam and Eve story, the CIA Adam and Eve story, so many have become aware of pole shifts and the cycles that have happened on Earth and completely cataclysmic nature in which Earth has found itself. So, Ben, hello. It's a pleasure to finally be doing this with you. Our followers have been waiting on this for a long time, and we're going to be dropping some truth bombs here tonight, aren't we?
Yes, we certainly are. Although, we're probably going to have to be a little careful while we're still on YouTube so that you and I don't have to, use the fallback plan of starting an OnlyFans channel.
All right. Hey, I'll talk about the pyramids. This is how the Egyptians built the pyramids. I'll do one button at a time, and, you know, you got to make ends meet somehow. And by the way, to everyone listening, so this is now streaming live on Rumble and YouTube simultaneously. However, approximately a half hour or so in, we're going to move it to Rumble, and it's for a very good reason. If people are not paying attention, now is the time. And I'm inclined to think that everyone listening right now is fully aware of the reasons why. We are living in an age where you can't speak the truth, because if you do, they'll go like this to your career. We've seen what happened with other notable people recently. And Ben, I follow you on social media, and I would encourage people to go follow both of us on Twitter. Your Space Weather News on Twitter, correct?
Yes, yeah, Space Weather News at Sun Weatherman. I don't know why you have two different names on Twitter. I still don't know why they do that. Or I guess it's now X, right? It's now X.
Right. I know it is Twitter. But I was seeing you recently tweet, though, where I was going with this, that they're coming for so-and-so, then they're coming for the Tates, and then they're coming, and then they're coming for us.
Oh, this is
how this, right? Like, this is how it works. Like, throughout history, whether it's, any totalitarian dictatorship regime, it'll eventually all go down to the state, where nobody will be able to share news or information or teach unless you are a state-sponsored character, and they are coming for all of us. Like, this is literally, if there's anything the history has taught us, is that it repeats itself. It's not cliche. Humans are very predictable, and the powers that be will eventually, the censorship will just continue into oblivion. So with that said, what should we be worried about? What's the current state of affairs in this world involving cataclysms, censorship? We can dive into censorship when you hear over to Rumble, maybe. But what are your thoughts? What's your forecast?
Well, the general theme is we're in trouble. We're in trouble from nature. We're in trouble from a civilization perspective. We're in trouble from a spiritual perspective as a people. If it seems like the world has gone crazy faster than normal, if it seems like people who have a lot of power in this world appear to be both Satanists and pushing their agenda harder than ever, you're right. But the reason is because they're watching another clock, and that is the clock of the sun. And yes, there's a hand that's played in there by the galaxy and the galactic magnetic field. But essentially what we've got is, as you were mentioning, there are these cycles on Earth. And some of the more important ones are 1,500 years, 6,000 years. But the most important one is where they sync up at 12,000 years. And that is basically where we are right now. It's my opinion that, one of your favorite topics, Atlantis, it's my opinion that this is what took out Atlantis about 12,000 years ago.
Great shout out to your work on that, by the way. I think you're really on point with the Rashad structure and everything. I think there's some evidence to suggest that it was a vast empire, but in terms of the capital, or at least one of the major major centers of that civilization, I think you're right on point.
I really appreciate that, Ben. And I will say, like, I agree with you. Like, I think it was a global civilization. I have another friend. We have a mutual friend, Nikki Anna Jones.
I know, Nikki.
Yeah, she says she thinks Atlantis was an epoch of time. And I'm like, yeah, I think you're right. It was a period of time where this world was much different. And, you know, I tell people, like, as far as, you know, the Eye of the Sahara, Rishat structure being the lost location of the capital city, when it comes to the nature of pole shifts, this is one thing that's got me further away from the Younger Dryas cosmic impact theory. Although I think it's very possible or even likely that the Earth got hit by something in that period of time, when I look at that water erosion that blasted the Sahara Desert, that to me is not the result of some meteor or asteroid hitting the Mediterranean Sea in a flow of, you know, tidal force of water. I think geomagnetic.
Chuck Doubleday. He's a writer, researcher, field explorer. He has a YouTube channel. He's like an amazing, I think he's a wizard. I met him in person, and he's just like a very cool dude who you need to know. And he's very obsessed with rocks, and he's got some new theories about them that I think everybody should pay attention to. So welcome aboard, Chuck.
Nikki, I really appreciate it. It was great. Just meeting you at the conference up there in Illinois, and you had tons of energy, and you were like, "I love rocks."
I do. And okay, so back us up on how you got into even looking at the world in a different way. So Jock has some theories, and we'll get into that. But he also spent 3 years in the Bosnian pyramids? Is that right?
I mean, it was 23 months total working there.
Okay. So, did you have a big interest in that kind of stuff before? Or like, walk us through how you got into all this. What happened to you?
Oh, okay. It was really a specific moment in my life, and it was bizarre because I'd always loved rocks as a kid, and I would collect agates and stuff, and I had a rock polisher, and I would polish rocks, and I would, you know, I built a display case my own, like, as a 15 or 16-year-old, I built my own display case and got black velvet, and I put the rocks in the display case. I was totally obsessed with agates and translucent things and moss agates, and anyway, I think a lot of people have the same obsession. I mean, rocks are so beautiful. I mean, especially the translucent ones where there's, like, worlds inside of them, you know, and you're like, wow, this is amazing. So you polish them up, and they're beautiful, and you look at them, and so I was doing that. I was totally, you know, some of the kids were doing crazy stuff, and I was just with my rocks, you know. I was just the most wholesome kid in the world, you know. I think because my parents are extremely wholesome. I mean, like, Mayberry RFD wholesome, you know. Anyway, so I was many years later, I was a young adult in my probably mid-20s or late-20s, I think, and I was in Ventura, California. I was walking down the sidewalk, And there was a bunch of books, like, piled on the sidewalk, like 10 books. Someone had just left them there, and I was like, oh, cool, someone left books, and maybe I'll find a book I like. And so one of the books was Fingerprints of the Gods by Graham Hancock. And I thought, this looks cool. And, I mean, I had read books on pyramids and stuff before, and I was really interested in this one book that I had was really old, written probably 100 years before, and it had talked about the golden ratio in the chambers in the Great Pyramid. So since there was clearly something going on, it wasn't just primitive stacking stones, there was something happening, you know, and I was like, this is fascinating, you know, but I didn't do any other stuff. I was a writer, I was writing screenplays, plays, so I wasn't going to pursue ancient history at all. I just loved it. It was like sort of like hobby reading, you know, like some people like romance novels, but they're not going to become, you know. Anyway, so I read this book, and I was like, that's the most important book I've ever read. And I've read so many books in so many subjects, you know. I was like, this is the most amazing book. And then I got his other book, Underworld. I mean, he's written many, but I got that one. And those two books became the two most important books I'd ever read. And I told Graham that in the Bosnian Pyramid Complex when he came to visit it. And he was very happy to hear that. That book was the thing that got me in, because it was like this really clear, reasoned, non-crazy sounding, you know, because Graham writes in a really scientific way, and he's just leading you along, going, well, look at this evidence, and what do you think about this, and perhaps it could be like this, and I was like, wow, this is amazing, you know, not what we thought, you know. So then, years go by, and I see on Facebook this post that someone made saying that there's pyramids in Bosnia, and I was like, okay, that sounds crazy, but I didn't go, you're crazy, because I didn't have the evidence to back that up. So I was like, well, I'm going to go look into it and find out if this person is posting nonsense, and if so, I'll say, here's the evidence that shows that you're posting nonsense. But I would always deal in evidence. I would never just go, you're a bad person. I don't like you. You're crazy. Shut up. There's no reason to. You just have to deal in evidence. You were talking earlier about how it just seems like there's a mob of people with negative stuff to say, but they never have evidence. No. They never deal with evidence. They don't want to have a conversation. They want to say that you're a bad person and you're wrong. It's like, okay, well, that doesn't further our species in any way.
I agree.
You know, because science is a conversation among persons with evidence. That's what it is. So if you don't have evidence, you should shut them up, is what you should do, until you have some evidence, and then join the conversation. Awesome. You are welcome. So anyway, I wrote an article called Evidence is King. Go find that one. Anyway, also Science is a Harsh Mistress. Go find that article.
So you were like, oh, okay, Bosnian Pyramid.
I saw that Facebook post, yeah, and so then I researched it. I immediately found an interview with Semir Osmanagic, who discovered the pyramids in April of 2005, and it was, I think it was 2 hours long, and I was like, this guy, just like Graham, he was just doing the science, northern orientation, the north side of the Bosnian Pyramid of the Sun, the orientation to cosmic north, just data, he would just keep going, and I was like, this guy doesn't sound crazy. And totally convinced me in that one interview that there are pyramids in Bosnia. I said, oh, I got to go volunteer on this project, because they just started a volunteer program in 2010. And this was summer of 2011 when I found this information. I was like, I wrote to them and I said, I want to volunteer. And they go, we're full up for the summer of 2011. Sorry, love you. And I was like, I'm coming. See you soon. Like, I wasn't going to take no for an answer. I wanted to go and shovel some rocks, you know, shovel some fill-in material from Robney Tunnel is what I wanted to do. So anyway, I showed up. I talked to Samir. He said, okay, organize a scientific conference. He accepted me as a volunteer, and he said, I'll give you breakfast and a hotel room. And I was like, awesome. So we made that deal in about 1 minute, and then he drove to Sarajevo, and I was like, yay. I'm in Bosnia, and I can work on the project. So I organized a scientific conference. Then I said, I could stay after the 3 months of volunteering. I said, I could stay. And so did a little bit longer, but then the money ran out, the foundation ran out, and he was helping me financially to survive in Bosnia because I didn't have any money, you know. So he was paying for my apartment, but then the money ran out. He's like, well, after that month, we don't have the money. So I said, okay. So I left, and then a few years later, in 2014, Samir said, hey, do you want to come back and do some videography for the foundation and make some short scientific videos of different features in the Bosnian Pyramid Complex? And I was like, yeah, I'd love to do that. I mean, I'm a writer, but I had made these little amateur videos with an amateur camera and pumped YouTube with Bosnian Pyramids videos when I was there. So he liked those videos, and because I'd just go up to somebody in the field, a volunteer or a worker or a tourist or a scientist, and I'd go, what's happening? They would always just immediately respond in this amazing, spontaneous, fantastic way. No one was ever like, oh, I'm too shy. They're just like, this is what I'm thinking right now. And I'm like, this is awesome. I just put it on YouTube. So he liked him, and he goes, let's do that thing. 2014 is when he asked me. And so summer 2014, I came out with the volunteers. They're there for 4 months, and I made videos for the foundation. And then at the end of 4 months, the center I could stay, Bosnia. And so he paid me the same salary that he was paying me before. It's a Bosnian salary. It's not like a European or American salary. It's not really that much. But I was thankful. I would have done it for free, but I just didn't have the money, you know, to do it for free. So he said, sure, stay through the winter, and you can write articles for Wikipedia and Wikinews on Bosnian pyramids and interview scientists that come through in the winter, because sometimes the scientists even come when it's freezing cold and rainy. And I was like, okay. So I did that, and then next summer I said, hey, Samir, I could stay for the next summer. I could stay for this summer too. And so I ended up staying 16 months straight in that stint, plus the 3 months as the volunteer, so it was 19 months total. So that was my Bosnian pyramids thing. That was the introduction to, and that's where I start to get my new ideas about continents of Terra.
So before we get to the continents of Terra, explain to me, like, okay, Graham Hancock actually thinks that the Bosnian are not a pyramid. So what, how do you, like there's, I've had that Uncharted X guy on here, Ben, who said that, he's like, oh, if you just look at Google, look at the aerial view. A lot of people say that. They say that they are not actually pyramids. How do you refute that?
Everybody has their own opinions. There are still some people who say there's no pyramids there, but I mean, the tourists who go there have never heard of or seen or heard.
Yeah, I have two friends in real life who are like, what do you mean they're not pyramids? Like, it's manipulated all around it. So if it's, even if it's not an actual pyramid, it's a manipulated mountain.
Right. So the tourists never say, I didn't get my money's worth. I came from Korea or Vietnam or, you know, Russia or Germany or Australia, and there's nothing here except hills. No, no one's ever said that. The tourists know that there's ancient structures there. So Bosnian Pyramid of the Sun is one, and Bosnian Pyramid of the Moon is the other. That's what Samir called them when he first discovered them that day in April of 2005. There's other structures there too. Tunnel systems. He knew that there'd be tunnel systems because he had been doing pyramid research for 10 years in many countries all around the world. He's writing books on pyramids. And so when he came back to his home country of Bosnia, he was like, in Visoko, he said, that looks like a pyramid. You know, he knew what a pyramid looked like because he'd been doing it for 10 years. His compass, he said, oh, it's oriented cosmic north. He got on top of it, looked over, there was the Bosnian Pyramid of the Moon. He started naming them, and then there's probably about 16 structures now, tumuli and different things. So everyone's welcome to their opinion on this. If anyone wants to go to my YouTube channel, Bosnian Pyramids with an S, youtube.com Bosnian Pyramids, it won't come up because they're throttling it, but you got to type the whole thing in. And a whole bunch of other nonsense will come up, but you just type that whole thing in and you're golden. you'll see the evidence of the building. It's just endless videos that I made, and of course many people have made similar videos, and you can find those, but some channels don't believe that there's pyramids in Bosnia, and that's fine too. Yeah, people should look at both and decide what they think. I don't care. I mean, I used to really be all passionate about convincing every person on the planet, and now I'm just like, there's other things to do. We don't have to convince anybody of anything, actually.
That's true.
Humanity is going to slowly move toward the good, I think, and the awakening, in the awakening. No matter whether we convince 100% of the people or not, even if we just have 10% of the people who figure out what's really going on in each realm of knowledge, that's enough to move us forward, I think.
Okay, so let's get into then.
No matter whether we convince 100% of the people or not, even if we just have 10% of the people who figure out what's really going on in each realm of knowledge, that's enough to move us forward, I think.
Let's get into then what formed for you. Like you're actually like looking in the creek beds of the Bosnian pyramid, and you're seeing all these fractures, and your mind starts thinking bigger. So how did this form for you?
It was interesting because I've chastised myself looking back because I was there for probably 17 months total, 23, before I thought to myself, I wonder if the riverbed is the foundation of these structures, because the structures found themselves along this river called the Fojnica River, which also meant another river in the town of Visoko, which is why Visoko is so important, because there's two rivers there. And so the Fojnica comes, it's from the west to the east, and it goes north through the complex. And then as the Fojnica is going north, it joins the Bosna, or we would call it Bosnia River, coming in from the east, and they both go north together. Now, there's very few rivers that go north, interestingly. So why are these rivers going north, you know? So both rivers are built. I went in August 5, 2015, to explore to see if the riverbeds themselves were built. It just never occurred to me. So as soon as I thought of it, I was like, I got to get in the river. So the Fojnica is just this really placid, beautiful river, nice cold, cool water, and you can put on your sandals and just walk up the river. It's about like knee high or thigh high or something like that. And there's fish in it, and there's people fishing and inner tubing down. The natives are inner tubing down, you know, sometimes. Or they're having a picnic along the river, and that's it. There's no tourists down there because the tourists are up on the excavation sites. You know, they'll get bussed in or whatever, or vans will take them in. And so the people would rarely be on the river looking for anything archaeological. And I was like, oh, I wonder if they're the foundations for the pyramids, because the riverbed itself is the foundation for the pyramids. Because that would make sense, because then If the Boston Pyramids builders had set their pyramids on the earth, any river that was coming through could outside in a flooding scenario, right? I thought, well, they're not gonna have their pyramid topple because of some floods that come through over the millennia, right? So they're gonna build the foundations down. Well, how deep did the foundations go? No one had ever found the foundations of these massive structures, the biggest pyramids, documented pyramids on the planet. Ritanya Mountain in Serbia, which is actually a three-sided pyramid, is much, much bigger than the Bosnian pyramids, but it doesn't have the documentation of the Bosnian pyramids.
That's the backboard behind you?
The Matterhorn.
And do you think the Matterhorn is a pyramid?
Well, you see, the thing is, Ken Rolla talks about mountains as scalar wave generators, or scalar field generators. So around every mountain is this incredible scalar field because of the compression of the weight of the mountain itself is compressing its own material and forcing something called a piezoelectric effect. And this creates a scalar field around it for kilometers and kilometers around every single mountain. So it's like whether you would call it a pyramid or a mountain, to me, they're both performing energetic functions. So, you know, it's just a question of terminology, really. But the key is the artificiality of it. So now most people...
Yeah, I'm starting to get on that way of thinking as well. So, okay, go on. So the key to the artificiality is...
Well, I mean, most people would think, this guy is hinting that mountains are not natural. That's nonsense. I'm tuning out. Well, yeah, don't tune out yet. Because if you look at academia's for how mountains are formed, plates come in, so there's this... these seams of fire, these rings of fire, these underground volcanoes in the seabeds. And so they're pushing apart the seabeds. And so Dimya had to figure out
it's almost
a way
11.
To suppress.
I gotta get some breakfast. I'm hungry.
Our expanding earth. They said, oh, well, yeah, the seabeds are.